Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the National Planning Framework. And we're joined today by Tom Arthur, Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, Fiona Simpson, who's the Chief Planner, Andy Kinnaird, who's the Head of Transforming Planning, Cara Davidson, Head of Environment and Energy, and Carrie Thompson, who is the Head of Development Planning and housing at the Scottish Government. And I just want to really warmly welcome you all. I think this might be the first time we've all been in the same place together at this during the process of the NPF4. And I know it has been a great deal of work. And around this time last year, it was being brought in. And I think it's been tremendous to see that you've really taken on board a great deal of what's come back as feedback, and such an important piece of work as we look forward to the next 10 years in Scotland and shaping in response to climate and biodiversity emergencies. I would also like to welcome Liam Kerr, who is attending for this item in his capacity as a member of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Welcome. And I would... And we're just going to go straight to questions. So I want to begin by focusing on how evidence and feedback... Apologies, so just a little bit of confusion there. So I'd like to actually invite the Minister for a brief statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and a good morning to the committee. And let me begin by saying I very much welcome this opportunity to come back and address the committee again on NPF4 now that we have our revised draft before the Parliament. And I am delighted to be at this stage in the NPF4 journey. As you recognise, Convener, getting to this point has taken a mammoth effort and a commitment by so many people, to whom I am all exceptionally grateful. It has taken 3 years, 3 wide-ranging and wide-reaching public consultations, extensive stakeholder engagement, and a thorough parliamentary scrutiny, which this committee led on earlier this year. I gave my commitment to listen very carefully to what people were telling us about the earlier draft and to take the time needed to get NPF4 right, both in its intent and in its structure and specific wording. We have reached this revised version by engaging with others. We listened, we learned, and we changed the document where needed. And I was delighted to hear the feedback presented to the committee last week, overwhelmingly recognising the significant improvements in clarity and focus of NPF4 and its policies. And I've also been delighted by the very substantial support from across society to the change in direction and how we plan Scotland's places and communities. It is a rare thing for any planning strategy to unite so many different interests in the way that NPF4 has. That is not to say that we are enjoying universal agreement on everything, of course, nor could we ever expect that in planning. A planning document will inevitably generate a range of views. There will be always those who support and those who do not support any given planning policy. In this revised draft, we have made choices informed by all of those views. In doing so, it is not possible, as a committee would recognise, to please everyone. We are charting a new course for Scotland's future development, with climate and nature and a well-being economy all central to our thoughts and decisions. NPF4 is about less compromise and about a clearer commitment to net zero. As Professor Cliff Haig noted here last week, we now don't have much choice about having that focus. We will not shy away, therefore, from the challenges that society faces, nor from the difficult decisions that may need to be made. NPF4 will ensure that Scotland has a truly plan-led system. We have different views on how far planning policies can and should go towards prescribing the outcome of a planning decision. This is perhaps because too often decisions have been made which compromise on the development plan. NPF4's strong policies will provide more certainty and confidence for all of us so that if proposals are supported by a sustainable, locally driven plan that has been developed with communities, we can all have more confidence that they will be delivered on the ground. While NPF4 is now very clear in its intentions, there will still be some flexibility at the local level, and each case will still be treated on its own merits. That is hardwired into our planning system, which allows and indeed requires professional judgment and discretion to be applied. I know that there are some concerns about implementation and how competing policies will be reconciled in specific cases. In every planning decision, there will always be planning policies that support the proposal and those which do not. That is why we always stress the importance of reading NPF4 as a whole. It is also why the planning system is operated by professionals, whose job it is to apply professional judgment and provide sound advice to inform democratic decisions. If decisions are backed by strong planning policy, which is clear in its intent, I believe and I know that Scotland's planning authorities will be up to the job. Indeed, the strong focus on well-functioning, healthy, high-quality places, strongly featured across NPF4, is why people get into the planning profession in the first place. We are nearing the end of the beginning for NPF4, and I'm very keen that we go on now and move into implementation. In a few weeks from now, I will ask Parliament to give its approval, and should that be agreed, we will move swiftly to adoption and give NPF4 its new statutory status as Scotland's development plan. I do not underestimate the scale of the work that lies ahead to deliver NPF4. That is where I and my officials are turning our focus. After several years of policy development and legislative change, we're now ready to shift our attention fully to delivery. However, we cannot deliver NPF4 alone. It will take further wide-reaching cross-sector collaborative commitment. The Scottish Government will be a key actor in driving and supporting that implementation. Monitoring will also, of course, be vital. This is the first time Scotland has a standard set of national planning policies. It will take some time to establish whether the policies are being implemented as intended, where there is room for improvement, and where there is a need for the detail to be adjusted. We will be monitoring this very carefully, while also supporting interpretation of policies. We will also work with everyone involved in planning to build skills and share experience, particularly in the first instance for the newer areas of policy, such as climate change, the nature crisis, and community wealth building. The committee is well aware of the resource pressures facing the planning system, our authorities, and the wider public sector. I want to reiterate my commitment to progressing the work we are doing with our partners through the high-level group on planning performance, with the planning profession and with our authorities, to raise the positive profile of planning and to make progress on its effective resourcing. Convener, we have made clear throughout our work on NPF4 exactly where our priorities lie for Scotland's future development. Our task now, and in the vote which is to come, is to consider whether the NPF4 is doing enough to address the global climate emergency and nature crises, and doing this in a way which improves our places and builds a sustainable wellbeing economy. We cannot afford to miss this opportunity to make real and progressive change. I have welcomed and appreciated the committee's support and hard work in its careful scrutiny of NPF4, and I look forward to your questions this morning and what I'm sure will be an interesting and stimulating discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. You covered a range of things in your statement, and I think I want to begin by focusing on how evidence and feedback on the revised draft will be used. The planning stakeholders have suggested several possible improvements to NPF4 during last week's session. Firstly, how will these and other stakeholder suggestions be taken on board before NPF4 is formally adopted? And secondly, Can you commit to further engagement when MPF4 is in place to improve areas which do not work as intended through perhaps a chief planner's letter?
Thank you, Convener. I would say that the answer to your first question lies in your second question. We have arrived at this point, as I alluded to in my opening remarks, through an extended period of work, over 3 years of work now to get to this point. And the intention is now, and what we will do, is bring forward the MPF4 draft as revised before the committee for consideration today to Parliament for a vote. Under the legislation, a parliamentary vote is required before ministers can adopt. So this is the revised version that we will bring to Parliament for a vote. So there is no scope at this juncture for changes or amendments. To do so would be to effectively reopen the process again and delay getting on with the work of implementing and delivering MPF4. But with regards to your second question, engagement, collaboration, partnership working, that is absolutely essential for the delivery of MPF4. And so we have set out in our delivery programme, in its first iteration, how we will work with partners to help achieve that. And of course, the delivery programme will be reviewed after 6 months, and I am very grateful for those who have already offered comments about what changes they would like to see and what additions they would like to see into the delivery programme. So that is something we will engage on. And of course, as I again stated, referenced in my opening remarks, through our monitoring process, we will be able to learn how the policies are actually delivering on the ground. We will begin to see how this impacts on the development of new LDPs. And it is through that process that we will then be able to evaluate the impact MPF4 is having. There is provision within the legislation to the 2019 Planning Act to amend MPF4. We will bring forward those regulations next year. But clearly, any changes to MPF4 would have to be evidenced and carefully considered. The priority and the focus now is on the adoption of MPF4 subject to Parliament's agreement, and then its implementation and delivery, which will be done in a genuine spirit of collaboration and partnership working.
Thanks very much for that response. It's really heartening to hear the continued commitment for engagement and collaboration there. I'd like to touch on resourcing and biodiversity because I've heard you talk a number of times in conversations about MPF4 about the fact that, you know, it is climate and biodiversity that is the kind of headline here that we're trying to attend to. And last week, Bruce Wilson, who's the head of policy and advocacy at Scottish Wildlife Trust, said that there's a lack of resources to actually measure biodiversity, that this threatens the ability of planners and developers to understand what is at risk and how they must modify developments to safeguard biodiversity. The increased workload of this additional responsibility is further augmented by the shortages in planners across Scotland. Therefore, I'd like to understand how will the government ensure that local authority planning departments are resourced and supported to properly evaluate and monitor the impact of developments on biodiversity?
As I indicated in my statement, or in response to questions to my statement in Parliament last year when I introduced the draft NPF4, resourcing of our planning system is a priority for me. To realise the ambition and vision within NPF4, we need a properly resourced planning system. So the actions that I've taken since then include increasing planning fees from April this year, which there is already some evidence to suggest is feeding through into additional positions within some planning departments. We are working through the high-level group to support the work, collective and collaborative work to address challenges around recruitment and retention. So, for example, the Future Planner project, which I was delighted that the Scottish Government was able to provide financial support to, has developed a report which has provided a series of recommendations for how we can recruit more people into the planning profession and indeed to help retain people within the planning profession. I should note that the challenges that Scotland faces around recruitment within our planning sector are not unique to Scotland. They're much wider challenges, but I'm clear that it's the responsibility of the Scottish Government to be doing all it can to support our planning authority partners to ensure that we do have a well-resourced planning system, which we've taken action towards through higher fees, and we are continuing to take action towards through engagement and dialogue on how we can move to a model of full cost recovery, which is an ambition but requires careful consideration to avoid unintended consequences, and on ensuring that we have a sufficient workforce within our planning sector through the Future Planners Project. We are taking action there in partnership with our key partners to assist in making sure that we maximise the number of people coming into the profession and staying in the profession. Final point I would want to make is to recognise that NPF4 provides an opportunity to really inspire many, many more people to choose planning as a career. Planning is a wonderful career choice for any young person thinking about what they want to do in life. It provides an opportunity to make a huge and impactful difference, not just to their own communities, but to the country as a whole. Planners will be at the forefront of shaping our places and ensuring that we can meet our obligations to reach net zero by 2045. Specifically on the issue of biodiversity, I don't know if there's anything you really want to add, Cara, about the specific support providing there, and particularly given the new policies that are coming online.
Yeah, I can add that Scottish Government has commissioned research to explore options for a biodiversity metric or other tool, and will be working with Nature Scot on a programme of engagement as that work moves forward.
And will that be linked into the biodiversity strategy and the Natural Environment Bill? Will it be a kind of cross connection there?
It's certainly a cross-collaborative exercise across both Scottish Government, including colleagues leading on those work streams, but also with Nature Scot as well. So absolutely, it's a very joined-up exercise, and we're keen to engage across the piece as that work moves forward.
Thank you very much for that. It's good to know that that's happening. It seems to be like a critical tool we'll need. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and your officials too. Tom, you spoke at great length here, which was very welcome, about NPF4. We can't do it alone. It's not a standalone document. It's going to be wide-ranging, cross-sector, and so on. And we had some of that discussion, I would say, over the period of time we've looked at the progress of NPF4. And last week, Professor Haig widened it out as well to talk about how it might interact and interface with other departments within government. We heard too that our Irish colleagues in government there, their departments actually set out how they will deliver their priorities within their framework of their own NPF. So is that something that you see happening here in Scotland, that the other Scottish government departments will be able to show, to demonstrate how their policy delivery interfaces and interacts with NPF4.
I want to respond in making two points. Firstly, on process, this has been a cross-government endeavour. Over 200 officials have been involved in the development of NPF4. And of course, it has really been a collaborative effort right across wider Scottish society and the Parliament with the process that has got us to this day. So it is by design that it reflects the full gamut of Scottish Government policy. But beyond that, planning by its nature touches upon every aspect of our lives, from the homes we live in to the places we work, where we go to for leisure and recreation, to the spaces that give us a sense of identity, to how our economy operates and functions. Planning is inherent in every aspect of how modern contemporary society functions. So it is inevitable that in a work of this stature and magnitude, that every aspect of government policy will have had input. And clearly, yes, there is a focus on the climate emergency and the nature crisis. But that is a lens through which all other policies have been considered. And that is what NPF4 seeks to bring together.
Mm. You'll have seen this morning that our colleagues in the Economy Committee, they have released their report on town centres, and many of the themes in that were covered during our discussions, particularly about how we improve the town centres, and some of the comments from our members and those giving evidence to us over recent months were talking about those particular issues too. So it's a good example for me of how it must cross-cut and embrace those issues that are coming out of a sister colleague committee's reports? Is that something that you support and we should hope to develop over the time that the MPF's in place?
Absolutely. I was delighted to give evidence to the committee earlier this year, and I'm been grateful to see that the report has been published. I have not had an opportunity to consider it in full yet, with it being published just this morning, but looking at the headline items that were covered, it's encouraging to see that there was such unanimous support and recognition of the key and vital role that our town centres play for our communities and for our country overall, and that is something that is reflected within NPF4, seeing our town centres and indeed our other local centres, our city centres, our commercial centres as key strategic assets. And I think what is, you know, will be, I'm sure, is recognised throughout the work that the committee has undertaken in looking specifically at town centres, as was recognised in our own Town Centre Action Plan, which we published earlier this year, and indeed is reflected within NPF4, is there is no single lever that we can pull to address the challenges that our town centres face, but it needs a collaborative, joined-up approach. Planning has a huge role to play in that. So does fundamentally reorganising and rewiring how our local economies work, and that's where community wealth building, something we'll have a lot more to say about in the new year, I think can have a very important role to play in ensuring that our economies and our local communities retain more wealth, which in itself will support vibrant and flourishing town centres.
OK. Thank you very much for that. Hopefully I can come back in later, Convener. Yep. Thanks, Minister.
Thanks, Willie. And I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your officials. Thank you for joining us. You just mentioned cross-government endeavour, which NPF4 has been, and I welcome the positive and constructive nature of discussions we've had, but I am concerned with regards to housing and where that currently sits within NPF4 and the housing crisis not necessarily being addressed. So I wanted to ask a few specific questions in relation specifically to how the revised NPF4 addresses the issue of potential under-delivery of land in pipeline going forward, and whether or not there is any trigger in place if that is not being brought forward.
We want to just go one question at a time. Yep. Now, well, firstly, we as a government recognise the centrality of housing. What we are seeking to do with NPF4 is move the debate on from one around numbers to one where we actually focus upon quality of place. A quality home doesn't end at the front door, and that is what we are seeking to do through NPF4. With regards to numbers specifically, by having the minimum all-tenure housing land requirement, which I appreciate the committee understands fully as a floor rather than a ceiling, that can help to provide that greater certainty. But it's important to recognise as well the role that local development plans will play. And as we work towards the introduction of the regulations that will commence new style local development plans and accompanying guidance, I'm committed to engaging with stakeholders, with HOPs and industry to ensure that there is clarity there. So that is going to play a key role as well. But with regards to some of the specific point you made, I'll maybe just ask Carrie to come in to address that on the question around the triggers and issues of them under delivery.
Morning. NPF, we do set out in there that where there is under delivery of housing, that the longer term sites that are allocated would be able to be brought forward. So in the pipeline, it's split into three different stages, years 1 to 3 short term, 4 to 6 medium, 7 to 10 long term. And then we've also asked for plans to allocate sites beyond 10 years as well. So if there are not, if the delivery isn't happening early on, then those longer term sites can be brought forward.
Okay, thanks. So can I give you an example of my own area here in Edinburgh? So 80% of all local development plan land currently is brownfield site allocated. 80% of that currently has businesses sitting on it who aren't, some of them not aware. The cat and dog home is also part of this. There's no plan for where they will then be moved to. So here in Edinburgh, where the housing crisis is acute, I don't see where that land will come. And that is the problem I hoped kind of a mechanism would be in place to address, because it's not going to come forward, as far as I can see, within that 7-year period anyway. So that's where I think there really needs to be a mechanism for adjusting that when we see this problem on the horizon, clearly here in the capital anyway.
Point I would stress is that where we are considering the NPF4 today, local development plans will have a very important role to play in this. And one of the things that NPF4 will allow is for LDPs to be less characterised by written policy and more focused upon spatial strategy. We will also, of course, be monitoring implementation and how NPF4 ultimately is delivering on the ground. So there will be that continuous process of engagement and, as I say, monitoring. And of course, that will be a learning process in itself, because, as I said in my earlier remarks, we have never had a national statutory planning framework before. We will engage ahead of the introduction of the LDP regulation and guidance. And of course, there is the means of if NPF4 were in any way not to be delivering what we would want to see when delivering, then of course we would take action. But it is really important to recognise the significant role that LDPs have in that. I don't know, Andy, if you maybe want to come in and just offer some views and a bit of information with regards to what we're doing, working towards LDPs, new style LDPs, and the guidance that we will provide. I know there was a concern around transitional arrangements as well being expressed by stakeholders. So it'd be grateful if you could provide some information on that, Andy.
Yeah, sure. Thank you and good morning. So this is the perfect example of how we do need to make sure we don't just look at NPF4 in isolation, but planning reform as a whole and how NPF and local development plans will work together. So for that reason, this time last year, we ran the consultations on NPF and on the new local development planning system at the same time, because they are just so closely interlinked. And likewise, coming into implementation phase, the links are there, I guess, for all to see. So on the assumption of NPF4 being approved and then adopted by ministers, we'll then want to move very quickly into laying the regulations that will bring the new local development plan regulations into play and let the authorities that are looking to get started on their LDPs get underway with that. So at that point of adoption of NPF, we'll also produce just a bit of guidance on the transitional arrangements for how that will fall into place. We published a couple of years ago just some guidance on how we expected the transitionals to work, so that those authorities that are already working through their existing local development plans will continue to do that and see that through to completion while the others can get started. So, it all just kind of flows. There's a sort of logistical kind of process of get through NPF, lay the regulations for the LDPs. The guidance won't come with that, which will also include some thematic guidance about implementing NPF through LDPs too.
I think one of the things that's really important to bear in mind is that central to this housing policy is getting back to a plan-led system. And that is something I think is absolutely essential for developing the kind of communities we want to see, but also for me for ensuring there's consistency with the obligations we have and indeed the policies within the document around addressing the climate emergency and the nature crisis. But as I said, I will engage closely with the house building sector, and we will have a programme of monitoring, and that will involve regular engagement. And as I also indicated in my opening remarks, as a government and as a division, planning, architecture, regeneration, we're moving from that phase of policy development and legislative change into delivery now, and that will, part of that will include a lot more engagement with planning authorities and with wider stakeholders.
Thank you, that's helpful, and I think the commitment to transitional guidance for sectors is something we have heard all sectors ask for, so it's good to have that on record. The committee's also heard concerns around a flood of local development plans being published shortly after the adoption of NPF4. And so I just wondered, what steps are the Scottish Government taking to ensure that local development plans will be phased in conjunction with MPF 4 as well?
To some extent, that will happen naturally. I think there's about five authorities which have recently are in the process of completing their LDPs using the existing arrangements. What we envisage is that within about 5 years, all planning authorities will have adopted a new style LDP. But the pace at which they do that will be determined by a number of factors: the age of the existing LDPs, the particular impacts specific to their areas of new policies, and also the capacity within their teams. But we will, of course, engage closely with authorities to understand what their plans are, and DPEA will be doing similar to assist them in their business programming. But I recognise the point, but this should also be recognised that it's not unusual that we will see different authorities moving at different paces, reflecting their particular circumstances.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. Do you want to go in? Yeah.
Supplementary on that, if I can, Minister, what will apply if a council's in the process of updating its local development plan and it hasn't quite reached that point yet, and NPF is adopted prior to that? What applies in terms of planning decisions locally? Is it the NPF4 or is it the current LDP in the local council? And will the guidance make clear which applies?
As set in the legislation, when NPF4 is adopted, the development plan will consist of NPF4 and a local development plan, but NPF4 will take precedence over any existing LDP. Once new LDPs come online, that situation is changed. It's there, the more up-to-date reflection of policy. But once NPF4 is adopted, if there's a conflict between an existing LDP and NPF4, NPF4 would prevail. I don't know if there's anything you want to add on that point, Andy.
Thanks for that, Minister.
Thanks, Willie. And we're now going to move to questions from Mark Griffin.
The committee have raised issues around a potential capital investment plan at previous sessions, and I think that was essentially to allow us to scrutinise how the ambitions of the document could be met. I just wonder if the Minister is able to set out why there was a decision taken not to include that capital investment plan, and if that's something the government would potentially reconsider.
I recognise that this has been something that there has been interest in from some stakeholders. What the delivery programme sets out is where there already is existing funding, whether that be through Infrastructure Investment Plan, the Place-Based Investment Programme, the Vacant and the Derelict Land Investment Programme, or Strategic Investment within Transport, the Investment within Housing. All of that will contribute towards delivering on the ambitions within NPF4. So there are a range of existing investment plans with which NPF4 aligns. And as these plans move on to further iterations, NPF4 will help to inform that. And I think that speaks to the importance of the delivery programme being a live document. So as the funding landscape changes, and we do, unfortunately, with the circumstances that we face it, our funding landscape can be volatile as a consequence of how devolution in the fiscal framework operates. It's important to have that flexibility there. But we will be in a position through the delivery plan to demonstrate how existing and new funding streams as they emerge align with the ambitions within NPF4. So while I recognise that there would be a call for something that would be perhaps a neat, concise, specific capital investment plan that was published alongside NPF4, I think in essence the delivery programme captures that intent. I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that point, Fiona.
Yeah, I would just add that our work on infrastructure, obviously we've proposed the Planning Infrastructure in Place Advisory Group in the delivery programme, and we have alongside that previously established an infrastructure delivery group, and that involves private sector infrastructure providers as well as obviously public sector. And I think that reflects the complexity of the picture here, so it's not as simple as a single capital investment plan that's fully funded by the public sector, but it's about that engagement with the private sector too.
That's the key point, because it's not solely public money that's going to deliver on NPF4. The private sector has a huge role to play. And even within the public sector, there's a mix between Scottish Government and local government as well. So it's quite a complex sort of funding landscape, and we seek to present, in terms of the public sector side, the money that's available through the existing funding streams and how that aligns with the ambitions and principles within NPF4.
Okay, if we can move on to another area. You've touched on the Mattler figures already, and I wanted to bring it back a stage before that to the housing needs and demand assessment tool that informs in. Last week at committee we heard evidence from witnesses who said that, you know, the Honda tool wasn't fit for purpose, both because it underestimated and overestimated figures. So, you know, contrasting evidence from witnesses, I'm concerned as well that it doesn't fully take into account the number of concealed households that are out there and potentially obstructs young people who have clearly got a demand and a need to go out and make their own way. I just wonder, given that there's conflicting views by witnesses, whether there's enough confidence in that tool and whether the figures that have informed, the work that's informed the Mattler figures is actually robust enough.
I'll ask Carrie to come in a moment, but what we have done is to take an evidence-based approach, and that is, I think we all recognise that that's absolutely vital. And so the numbers that we arrived at, that is based upon both national and local data. But it's also important to recognise that the Honda was a starting point in reaching the Mattler. So there's also flexibility within that. And there is also, it's important to remember, the opportunity for local evidence as part of the new style LDPs through the evidence reports to identify where there is additional need and demand. So there is that flexibility that is built in. I would say that the Honda guidance and the tool, they are kept under review and they are regularly updated in with regards to when there's release of updated household protection projections by NRS. I would say that Honda is well understood, it is well established, but I'd also recognise that the session last week that Homes for Scotland offered to facilitate a workshop for the committee on Honda, and I'm very keen to maintain positive engagement with Homes for Scotland, and so planning officials and those from the Centre for Housing Market Analysis will of course be happy to have discussions on the Honda tool and other matters with Homes for Scotland. But I don't know if there's any perhaps more detail you want to provide, Carrie.
On the Mattler figures, the process that was undertaken, we engaged quite a lot with the local authorities. We provided some baseline information that was national data and statistical based, but then we provided the local authorities with an opportunity to feed in local level evidence and information to inform it. So whatever data they have at their level, information based on policy ambition or policy drivers, they can use that to influence the data, the information that they fed into the figures and increase them. And what those figures will do will be a baseline for the next LDP. So we've expressed that they are minimum figures, and the HNDA would then be completed in full to inform the LDP as that progresses through the new system.
Okay, and can I just ask about the local engagement with the various planning authorities? Just to ask, did they all engage fully with that, or was there various levels of, you know, interaction with your department? How did they all fully engage?
Every authority responded, some collectively. The West of Scotland, the sort of Glasgow City Region area, they responded collectively. Every local authority is at a different stage of their housing and planning processes, so they provided the information that they were able to at that particular time. We've updated the information based on HNDAs that have progressed prior to the draft, and authorities will then also be able to use updated information as they are progressing their LDPs as well.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Gemma.
Thanks, Mark. I'm now going to bring Willie Coffey in.
Thanks again, Convener. Minister, we were also discussing at the committee and evidence about the infrastructure first approach to the whole planning system across Scotland. What kind of level of buy-in do you think there is from infrastructure providers to support that approach? We heard some evidence from witnesses over the period that we're involved in about how important that is to deliver and achieve that. So how confident are you that can be done?
Well, I think with the support that NPF4 provides, that can bring a degree of confidence and certainty. And I think it's certainly something that in my experience in the last 18 months as Planning Minister, is that this is a key interest from many colleagues, is the question of infrastructure. So I think this is a policy commitment within NPF4 that is very much welcome, but as important as NPF4 in itself is, there is a key role to play here for local development plans, and that will help, and they can play a very important role in securing that buy-in and providing that confidence at the local level. But I think at the heart of this is going to be collaborative working, and we set out through our delivery programme some of the practical ways in which we will seek to engender collaborative working. And also I've been trying to set out just more generally that the work that we do as a government moving from sort of policy and design into implementation can help to support that work as well.
Okay, thank you for that. And you mentioned yourself in response to one of the questions, community wealth building. There was some evidence, I think, at the committee that is a little bit lacking in clarity about its definition within NPF4 and what it means, and perhaps it's not so well understood in planning circles even now. So could you say a wee bit more about that, about how you might address that if you agree with those concerns and those issues, to make it clearer for everyone to understand?
Well, I would want to sort of recognise and welcome the comments from stakeholders who have themselves welcomed greater clarity on community wealth building within the NPF. Community wealth building is at different stages of implementation. You'll be aware from your own constituency, Mr. Coffey, that across Ayrshire, starting with North Ayrshire, now including the whole of the region, we have seen trailblazing work in community wealth building. I was delighted to be out and about in the area earlier on in the summer and seeing some of the great work that has been going on there through procurement, place-based approaches. So community wealth building will be something that more and more local authorities are going to take up. As things stand at the moment, there's 5 pilot areas that the Scottish Government has supported. There is a work that's taking place in Ayrshire. There's other local authorities on their own steam taking forward community wealth building approaches. We have a commitment as a government to supporting all local authorities to develop their own community wealth building strategies, and I'll have more to say about that in the new year. We also have a commitment to introduce legislation to support community wealth building, upon which we'll consult ahead of introduction. We've established a bill steering group in that space as well, and again I'll have more to say about that in the new year. So community wealth building is, and again it's referenced within our national strategy for economic transformation. Community wealth building is going to be a key tool and a key practical tool for realising the ambitions around a wellbeing economy, and it is something that is going to be integral to rewiring how our local and regional economies operate, so they operate in a way that sees less wealth extraction, more wealth retained by communities. And I think the situation is will transpire as this model is rolled out and more local authorities adopt it. We will see more local authorities with their own community wealth building plans, and as the policy references, that will have to be recognised in planning decisions.
Mm. Do you think there's enough understanding locally by local people about what we mean by community wealth building? Do they get it, I suppose, is the question I'm asking Minister, and how will they shape, you know, the public, how will they shape community wealth building plans as they develop? So we've always been in favour of taking a view that governments, councils shouldn't do things to people. We should do things with them and to embrace people at that ground level to enable them to shape policy development. So do you think there's enough local knowledge about what we mean by this, and is there enough opportunities for people to get involved in that process to help shape it?
I think the term community wealth building may be new to some people, but the concept underlying it is not. And certainly the key components, many of which are well established in Scotland, whether that be around sustainable procurement, supporting local businesses and localising supply chains, whether it be about the retention of local assets and seeing more local assets and community ownership, whether that be promoting fair work and progressive recruitment practices, indeed whether it be promoting more progressive models of ownership, be that co-ops, employee-owned businesses or social enterprises. These are all well-understood strands of work, many of which have had long-standing support from the Scottish Government and local authorities. What community wealth building does is bring a strategic lens to these decisions, to these individual strands, in such a way that we can affect quite significant and radical change of how our local and regional economies operate. And it's, I have to say, I'm heartened to see the interest today in community wealth building from right across the political spectrum and indeed from right across stakeholders. And I've had very positive engagement with, for example, the FSB in community wealth building, and I look forward to more constructive engagement going forward. This is something which has got real potential. It's not going to be an overnight fix. There's no silver bullets here to go and address all of the challenges our local and regional economies face. But community wealth building is something with a track record in other areas. It's already delivering on the ground and air. And I think as more and more communities adopt it through Scotland, we'll see the benefits of it. And spatial planning can have a key role to play in helping to deliver community wealth building, which is why I'm delighted that we do have this policy in NPF4. And while I can't say for certain myself, I do know from one comment contributor the suggestion that this may be the first planning policy in the world to have a specific community wealth building policy within it. So this is a demonstration of the commitment the government has to advancing the community wealth building agenda, and it's something that I very much hope to have the opportunity to discuss in more detail with the committee in due course.
Okay. Those comments are very welcome, Minister. Thank you very much. Convener, thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair, who's joining us online. Marie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Some of the evidence we received last week from stakeholders was some calls for improvement that could assist the general public. Would you consider publishing a non-technical summary of the MPF4 to aid community groups and others in understanding what can be fairly technical document that will be integral to future planning decisions?
Yes, absolutely. I want to see as much engagement within the planning system as possible. I've been clear that this will be a collective endeavour and this will take time, but I want to move the narrative from one of conflict to one of collaboration, and that means genuine community empowerment and engagement within the planning process. So we have tools at our disposal ready. We introduced the regulations and local place plans earlier this year, so they can provide a key opportunity for communities to be shaping their places. And I note the comments from last week, and I think it may have been Professor Haig who made them, which is with regards to often when we see engagement within the planning system, it's in a negative context of wanting to stop a development. I think actually we have so much insight and knowledge within our communities that we need to do more to harness, and for that to feed into our through local place plans and other mechanisms to ensure that communities are much more engaged at an earlier stage and have the opportunities to bear their experience, their local insight, and most importantly, their ambitions for their communities to bear on through local place plans and other measures on the local development plans that take place. I think that can do a power of good for planning overall, because it gets it much more into a space of talking about what we want to see rather than the developments we don't want to see.
Thank you for that reassurance. Some planning stakeholders are concerned that delivery continues to be the weakest point across NPF4 documents. Can you assure us that the policy priorities set out in the MPF4 will be delivered?
Apologies, could I ask you to repeat the question? I missed the first part of it.
Some planning stakeholders are concerned that delivery continues to be the weakest point across the MPF4 documents. How can you assure us that the planning priorities set out in NPF4 will be delivered?
I want to give reassurance, and I've sought to do that in the evidence that I've provided so far to the committee. As a government, we are turning, as I say, from the focus on policy development and legislative change to implementation. We are working constructively and collaboratively with stakeholders to ensure that the planning profession is supported and is resourced. And we will also, notwithstanding our focus on delivery, be rolling out the further provisions of the Planning Act 2019, which will help to support the delivery of NPF4 as well, such as master plan consent areas, for example. We also have a phased programme of permitted development rights review, which we're taking forward, which again can help to support on delivery. So delivery is an absolute priority, and monitoring will be key in assessing how we're progressing in doing that. But to deliver will require collaboration, and I'm absolutely committed to the closest engagement possible with stakeholders, because ultimately, planning is for everyone, but everyone has a role to play in making planning and in making NPF4 a success.
Thank you for that, Minister. No further questions, Convener.
Thanks, Marie. Just on that that piece about everybody needs to be, everyone has a role in the success. With the climate and biodiversity at the forefront, and then you mentioned at some point this morning and also in the past about that we need to be moving to a spatial strategy, and I would also say that maybe we're also facing a spatial squeeze. I think we've heard that some ways about Edinburgh with Miles Briggs' questions, and I just wonder if in the development of the NPF4, do you have a sense that sectors that are involved in developments or housing, for example, understand that they actually maybe need to change their business models? Because maybe what I'm starting to see across all of my work in the Parliament, in the need to respond to climate and nature emergency, business models need to change, and we have to move from how we're doing it now. We need to be really seeing how we're doing housing or anything else 10 years from now, 20 years from now. And I just want to get a sense, do you feel like that collaboration is really happening on the part of those sectors that will be putting in our infrastructure?
I think it is, and it comes back to the point that I think Bruno, I referenced earlier that Professor Hague made. We don't have a choice. We can say it is a social imperative or an economic imperative, or indeed an environmental imperative, but we do not have a choice. Climate change is happening. Yes, we have to mitigate, but we also have to adapt as well. And if we do not do that, the consequences, I think we can all say, would be incalculable. So we have put the climate emergency and the nature crisis right at the heart of NPF4 policy number one, but it runs through the entire vision of the document. But these considerations are not unique to government. Every business and every local authority is having these, having similar discussions. What NPF4 does is provide a clear direction within our planning system of the action that has to be taken, and planning is uniquely placed to help us address the climate emergency because of that power it has to direct in a coherent and considered and rational way the types of development that we need to see to meet these strategic challenges, and as well as that, given the timescales upon which planning operates over, there's no overnight fix, there's no quick cure. It takes sustained work, and that's why we've set out a vision to 2045 within the NPF4.
Thanks for that. It'll be interesting to see what happens once we start to move into that delivery plan phase and the changes that come about from the private sector. Just one of the, so digging down into a kind of bit of a policy area, one of the potential conflicts arising is between what we heard last week is between renewable energy and wildland. And one of the tests for allowing renewable energy development on wildland is that it will support meeting renewable energy targets. And concerns were raised by Scottish Environment Link and also John Muir Trust that by their very nature, all renewable energy developments meet this test. So I'd like to understand or yeah, understand how you can assure the committee, firstly, that the correct balance between protecting wildland and meeting renewable energy targets has been struck in MBF4, and secondly, that more clarity on this issue will be provided.
I would probably want to highlight the evidence provided by Scottish Renewables last week, which in themselves recognise both the way in which the significance of a renewable energy policy within NPF4, indeed at the forefront in thinking within a European context. But equally, what Scottish Renewables recognised was the existing protections that already exist for wildland and are retained. For example, the percentage of wildland that we find within our national parks or our national scenic areas. The other point I would make is it's very important when considering NPF4 to read the document as a whole, and ultimately decisions have to be considered on a case-by-case basis in conjunction with the development plan. That includes the local development plan as well, of course, and by the individual and the individual decision maker has to take all of these factors into consideration. Don't know if you'd want to maybe add anything, Cara.
I would just add that there is, of course, a separate process for setting out targets, including for onshore wind. So the draft onshore wind policy statement was consulted on, I believe that was autumn 2021, and I understand that colleagues will be bringing forward a final onshore wind policy statement shortly.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I can see that MPF4 is going to be core curriculum for all the new planners that we're going to be bringing on board. You've said a number of times it needs to be read as a whole. It's going to be that central document. I'd now like to bring in Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, panel. Last week, there was discussions around about, obviously, resourcing and upskilling planning staff, particularly around the DPA and so on. I think you just touched on that before, Minister, but that, and the RTPI mentioned that as well, and about recruitment. I'm just wondering if you can give us a little bit more on terms of, I think the estimate was 700 additional planners that were required, and we've heard that in Marine Scotland require that as well. I don't know if you can say any more on about what that process will look like over the next number of years in terms of that recruitment over that. I don't know if you can just expand on that a little bit about how, because again, it was mentioned, I think it was the NPF4 was welcome, but they need the resource probably at an early stage to try and deliver that.
Well, the first thing is I would do is I would encouraging all aspiring planners from out West Scotland and other parts of the UK to come to Scotland to work in planning and to help us deliver this really significant document. There isn't going to be a quick fix to the challenge. We all recognise that. I think there's the high level things that we can do about setting, really raising the profile of planning to make it as attractive a career choice as it possibly can be. And I want to be clear again, I think planning has so much potential to deliver so much good and would represent an excellent career choice for anyone. Beyond that, in terms of the practical work that we're doing, yes, there's the issues around resourcing that I've touched on earlier, fees, which is translating in some planning authorities to additional posts, work towards full cost recovery, with obvious caveat, there's complexities there, we don't want any unintended consequences, but that is a commitment taking forward. And then the work on the Future Planners Project, which is put forward, a report was published earlier this year and provides a number of thoughtful suggestions about how we can, about actions that we can take to increase the number of people coming into the profession. I don't know if you maybe want to touch on some of the Future Planners Project.
Yeah, so the Future Planners Project has a range of very practical suggestions, whether that's a planning apprenticeship scheme, is working with graduates in coming into the profession to give them a rounded experience as well, because some of it is about retaining planners in local authority services rather than them moving to the private sector. So there's a range of different things we can work with the profession, with heads of planning who are really keen to progress all of this. And I think part of it is about the planning profession itself, which we absolutely need more planners. But we also need to think about interdisciplinary working as well and how we work with the other built environment professions alongside planners themselves. So lots of work to do on it.
Okay, thanks, Fiona. The next question, Convener, was really just on, one of the key things I think the committee were keen to look at in this NPF4 was around about monitoring it over the next number of years. It's 11 documents, so what are the key metrics that we should be looking at? So I suppose that the key thing, the question for myself was how Is it going to be monitored from a government point of view and a directorate point of view in terms of that, and in terms of obviously reviewing policy and particularly going ahead over that the next 10 years, because obviously we've seen how much things have changed in the last 10 years. So to enable it to be a living document, how are we going to monitor that? And again, I think that's something that the committee would be keen to look at, is what are the key metrics? And I think we've mentioned this before, Andy, what are the key metrics in terms of that we'll be looking at, so that we can be looking at over a number of years? So just a bit from a government point of view.
I think the first point I would want to make is the recognition of monitoring is absolutely vital. This is something new following on from the 2019 Act. And I am keen to have the closest possible engagement, and I'm very keen to hear what the views and insights of the committee are, both at the point of adoption of NPF4, but as we move through that iterative process with the delivery programme. So I want to make that crystal clear from the start. But also recognising that we need to recognise, as we all do, that the impact of planning can take time to feed through. It's that's by just intrinsic to the very nature of the way in which planning operates. There's clearly a number of different metrics that we could go through, and I'll ask colleagues to come in a moment to touch on that. I was struck by something that Professor Haig said at evidence session last week, which is about we're recognising that, looking at how LDPs are shaping up and planning appeal decisions is important. There is also a need, particularly around that community engagement piece and ensuring that people feel involved, that we are reporting and discussing how NPF4 is having an impact in a way that is real and tangible and measurable as well. So I think there's a very important role for the sort of what we're set out within the delivery programme, but I think as well ensuring that we're making clear in a way that's accessible how NPF4 is actually impacting on the ground is very important. There's things that we can, other sort of strands of work in where there can be a role in monitoring as well. We're working towards the recruitment of the National Planning Improvement Coordinator, a role created by the Planning Act. There is also the work to create the new planning performance framework reports, which will replace the current voluntary regime. So these can all have a particular role as well, but I don't know if Fiona, you want to come in and just some.
Fiona, just before that, I think it's not just on government. I think there's obviously an emphasis on local development plans to have that same process there, because as you said, NPF4 is the framework. The local delivery sometimes is down by the local authorities, most of the local authorities. So I think there's an element in that as well, in terms of local development plans.
Yeah, and I think this is something that with that pivot that I spoke about earlier in terms of our focus as we move on to implementation and delivery of NPF4 is something that government can have sort of more active engagement on. But I'll ask Fiona to come in.
Yeah, no, I would say it's a work in progress for us around monitoring. So we've got choices to make. Do we make use of high-level strategic, broader data sets like the data and indicators used for the national outcomes? Or do we focus more on the specifics and the direct impact in terms of planning decisions and where LDPs are through the process? It's probably a mix of both of those things. So we need to work through that. I think digital as well will have a really important role to play. If we can get through the next stage of the digital programme, the digital strategy is focusing on data and how we use our data in a really smart way. So the idea being that the data sets will mean that at any point in time we'll be able to see what is happening, where the sites are, and bring that together from a national perspective that moves down to a local perspective. Again, lots of work to do on that, but that's the ideal.
Thanks for that. Camilla had one more question, if that was okay. And it's a specific issue. Last week you've probably been aware that the issue of out-of-town development and drive-throughs were raised, and it's been in the press and so on. So I was just really looking for a bit of clarity in that regard. I don't know if you're maybe for yourself, Minister, or Andy, or Fiona, in terms of that, but what the policy actually states. I know it's the press, I think, was quite confusing in terms of that, and it's been raised, I think, to all of us in certain occasions. So just wonder if you can give us a little bit of clarity on that one, if it's possible.
Yeah, certainly. I think there was some reporting of it which could potentially be misleading, misunderstanding. What the policy provides for is that drive-throughs should only go ahead if they're supported within the local development plan. And I think we would all recognise that that sits within supporting a range of policy outcomes around local living in 20-minute neighbourhoods, of course, or ambitions on reducing the amount of emissions, car travel, etc., and of course with regards to out-of-town scenarios too. But I would say that I'm conscious of the issues that were raised, and I will be engaging with relevant stakeholders to provide reassurance and clarity with regards to what the intent of the policy is and what it will seek to deliver.
Okay, thank you. That's clear. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. I'm now going to bring Miles Briggs in again, but on behalf of Annie Wells, he's got a few questions. Annie's with us online, but has a throat ailment. And then afterwards, I'm going to bring in Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener, and it actually follows up from Paul McClellan's question as well, because last week we did hear from Jim Miller, Chair of Head of Planning Scotland, who suggested his interpretation of Section 27D pointed towards a ban. And I think that's where there has been concern. I saw the Minister coming in with a coffee this morning. I don't know if he used the drive-through to get that or not, but part of what is important is making sure that when this gets down to local authority level, it's not misinterpreted. And Section 27, I don't believe, was even part of the original consultation and has had no further consultation on that. So I'm pleased to hear what the Minister had to say on that to Paul McClellan. But in terms of any future consultation on this, he said this is it. What will that look like in guidance going forward? Because I don't think that's clear from the interpretation people are taking from MPF4 currently.
As I made reference to earlier, we will provide, and this is speaking in general terms, we will provide advice on transitional arrangements should Parliament agree and approve MPF4. Following the adoption of NPF4, we will work to deliver the regulations and local development plans along with guidance there. So that is what we will do in general. I think the policy is clear, and I think when the policy is read, its intention is straightforward to understand. But as I've said, I will engage with relevant stakeholders within this sector to ensure that the intent of the policy is clearly understood. And I recognise that some confusion may have been caused with how it was misreported, but the policy is consistent with what we want to see in terms of a plan-led approach. Of course, with my coffee, it was always purchased in the garden lobby. Right. And the best coffees in Edinburgh.
I'm pleased to hear that, and I will feed that back to Kirsty as well. On a separate point, I think we've all welcomed the positive engagement and work around renewables. But I'm slightly concerned with regards to what that then means around there not being a specific strategy for grid reinforcement works. And I think that's something which is still missing within the document, and the delivery programme is maybe where the Minister will point towards that being in guidance. But I just wondered, in terms of renewables coming online, where that now sits within the potential development of major grid reinforcement works, which will be needed to realise that potential.
Well, I would highlight the status of strategic renewable electricity generation and transmission as a national development, and also the clear support for renewables behind the policy. But with regards to the detail of your question, let me ask Cara to come in.
Thank you, Minister. I would just give a nod back to Policy 11 itself, which sets out that the support includes for enabling works such as grid transmission and distribution infrastructure. We're obviously very well aware of the role and the strategic importance of the expansion of the grid network, not least because of its role in supporting the rollout of offshore renewables as well. So certainly Policy 11 makes clear support for that very reason.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. And Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. On that exact point of transmission and the grid, Policy 6B concerns forestry, woodland and trees. And it states that development proposals will not be supported where they will result in any loss of ancient woodlands, ancient and veteran trees, or adverse impact on their ecological condition. Now, during the consultation, various stakeholders, including SSEN Transmission, pointed out that such a black and white position means that transmission infrastructure, perhaps linking new wind farms to the grid, perhaps reinforcing the network to transport that clean power to areas of demand, or strengthening grid resilience for rural communities, in other words, Minister, meeting the strategic challenges that you talked of earlier, wouldn't be done on a case-by-case basis, and it would be unable to go ahead, at least without things like public inquiries. Now, this section hasn't changed in the revised draft. So what was the thinking, Minister, which led to rejection of those representations and no change?
I think with regards to Policy 6, it's important to recognise that our ancient woodlands are irreplaceable habitats. And given the clear commitments around tackling both the climate emergency and the nature crisis, there is an imperative to ensure that we are protecting these vital natural assets. I'm conscious of the concerns raised by SSEN, and just as a matter in interest of transparency, I will be meeting with them shortly. My officials already have had engagement to discuss these particular issues. With regards to the development of the policy, I'll perhaps just ask Cara to come in to provide a bit more detail.
Thank you. Again, I would just reiterate what the Minister has said there about MPF4 being read and applied as a whole. I would point back to your opening remarks, Minister, that there will always be judgments to be made based on the circumstances of individual case. It's already the case that grid connections are subject to planning requirements. And, you know, there is opportunity for judgment to be applied where public need may outweigh any negative impacts. I would just add that Policy 6 aligns with and reflects established Scottish Government policy on the control of woodland removal, which is set out in Scottish Forestry's policy.
I'm very grateful. I understand the points the Minister makes about the ancient woodlands. I wonder, that could probably be applied similarly to peatland. And of course, Policy 5 concerning peatland specifically concerns peatland and also wasn't changed. But that's in slightly different terms, because it says at Policy 5C, development proposals on peatland, carbon-rich soils and priority peatland habitat will only be supported for essential infrastructure and there is a specific locational need and no other suitable site. Now, that is an appropriately stringent but nevertheless arguably more sensible position, which recognises the importance of peatland, particularly in the drive to net zero, but allows for nuance where there are infrastructure projects such as transmission and those projects are required. Given that, Minister, would you consider reviewing Policy 6B such that it is more akin to or indeed mirrors the 5C on peatland?
I am, as I mentioned in my previous answer, happy to engage, and I will be engaging with SSEN to understand their concerns more in more detail, and I recognise the point that you're making, Mr. Kerr. I'm just very conscious of the significance of ancient woodlands and the fact that they are an irreplaceable habitat. But the point I would make is twofold. One is that we are at an end of a process which has taken some time to get here, so I want to focus on bringing MPF4 to Parliament for a vote of approval and then subsequently, in short order, adoption by ministers. However, I am absolutely committed to the closest monitoring and engagement of stakeholders going forward. No one wants in any policy development any outcomes that are not consistent with the intent. So through monitoring and engagement, which, as I've already indicated, I'm committed to undertaking already, we will look carefully and understand the concerns and monitor carefully any impact that this is having. But the position right now is that we will be bringing in PF4 back to Parliament for a vote of approval and subsequent, should Parliament agree, adoption by ministers. But there will be the closest engagement with all sectors, but specifically on the points you raised, and as they'll be meeting with SASE in shortly to discuss their concerns in more detail, and my officials already have had engagement.
Very grateful. That being the case, will there be guidance issued to assist local authorities interpreting sections such as 6B so that, for example, they could be assisted in deciding what the loss of ancient woodlands means, for example, where perhaps the developer was going to replace or even enhance what was there, accepting the point that the Minister rightly made earlier. And if there is to be guidance, does the Minister know when that might be out?
I would, on the sort of general point with regards to guidance and transitional arrangements, I would just refer to my earlier answer. We are committed to providing transitional advice shortly following a vote in Parliament, should Parliament approve. There will be guidance published alongside the regulations for the local development plans. That guidance will cover both the actual process of LDP development, but also thematic guidance with regards to how to reflect specific policies within LDPs. As to any concerns around specific guidance, of course, through the monitoring process, through the engagement, I will be happy to reflect upon any kind of issues or concerns that are raised. I don't know if you want to add any more to that, Andy?
Yeah, sure. And sort of guidance can take different forms as well. So it may be that there's a need for some sort of government published guidance, but also as part of our whole new approach of moving into that delivery phase within our own team, that will mean engaging with those who are delivering the policies themselves and kind of working together on the interpretation. So, you know, guidance can take different forms and could potentially be in the form of best practice as well.
I was just going to add that Policy 6 in particular just reflected on the fact that MPF doesn't sit in isolation. There is some existing guidance that supports the control of woodland removal policy. There is specific implementation guidance that supports that. And obviously, as Andy says, there are the wider plans around engagement and best practice sharing to support delivery of MPF specifically.
Final thing from me, Minister, you suggested throughout today, and for understandable reasons, that the parliamentary process for MPF4 doesn't allow for amendments to be considered at this stage. How can amendments be brought forward in the future, specifically given my line of questioning relating to critical national infrastructure and unavoidable perhaps impacts of developments on ancient woodland? And how soon can that amending process be commenced?
There's provisions to make amendments to MPF4, and that can take place at any time following the commencement of the relevant regulations. Clearly, careful consideration would have to be given. It would be not, a step that would be taken lightly, but that provision is there within the legislation for very good reason. And of course, should it be necessary to do so, then that would be taken forward in a way that is through consultation, engagement and evidence-led. I don't know if there's anything you want to add about the process, Andy?
No, that's other than that's a piece of work we'll start so early in the new year, once we have NPF through.
Once we adopt this, we'll be taking forward that process to provide that clarity. But yes, there will be a means of amending NPF4 at any time once it is operational and that provision is commenced.
Very grateful to the panel. Convener.
Thanks very much, Liam. And I just want to say that concludes our questions and really, really appreciate all of you coming in to hear what you had to say about MPF4 and the work you've been doing. It's been a very useful session and I look forward to the next steps in this process. And I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes before we move on to our next item of business. The third item on our agenda today is to continue our scrutiny of the National Care Service Bill. Today we have two panels of witnesses who represent people receiving social care. For our first panel this morning, we are joined online by Mike Burns, who is today representing the Granite Care Consortium, but he is also the CEO of the mental health charity Penumbra. We have Sophie Lawson, who is Policy and Participation Manager at the Glasgow Disability Alliance, Stephanie Fraser, who is the Chief Executive of Cerebral Palsy Scotland, and Andy Miller, the Strategic Lead for Participation and Practice at the Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And if they could indicate when they wish to respond to a particular question by putting an R in the chat box, I will make sure we bring them in. We only have an hour for this panel, so can I remind members to address your questions to particular witnesses where possible? And of course, I'm going to go potentially against that request when I begin my questions. So I'd like to begin by focusing on the challenges facing care delivery. And firstly, what are the, I'd be interested to hear what, from your perspectives, are the main problems with the way social care is delivered currently? And secondly, do you agree that there's currently a postcode lottery in care delivery at the moment in Scotland? And I'll start with Stephanie Fraser, but then also open up to others. Stephanie.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me here to the committee. People with cerebral palsy fall between the cracks. Cerebral palsy is a very good bellwether condition because it is it's a long-term condition. There's no medical procedure or drugs that can make things magically better. You will lead as long a life as anybody else if other complications don't occur. And what you can achieve in life and how independent you can be depends on how involved your disability is and also what is your access to help and support. So people with cerebral palsy fall between the cracks of the current system. People with very involved CP who have a large care package from childhood are relatively okay. But when those needs change, and people with cerebral palsy's needs do change as they age, even though it's not a progressive condition, needs will change, then who is able to assess this? And people who maybe as children and young adults don't need access to care, quite often need access to some care as they age. And there is confusion around how they can access this, whether it's health or whether it's social care. And thresholds, referral criteria are cumbersome. The health and social care system at the moment is not fully integrated. It's too disjointed, and there's too little access to condition-specific expertise when it's required. So people are passed from person to person without anybody, one person taking responsibility. There aren't any specialists for adults with cerebral palsy. And you asked whether there was a postcode lottery. I would say it's not as simple as one area is better than another. If someone with CP has access to, whether it's a social worker or whether it's an advocate or whether it's a physiotherapist or whatever it might be that helps them navigate the system, then they will have a better outcome. And it's just potluck as to whether people find that positive first person.
Thank you very much for your response, Stephanie. That's very helpful. Andy, you've indicated that you'd like to come in as well.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, everyone. A lot of people with learning disabilities experience similar situations to what Stephanie's just described. I would say that systemically, it is more of a postcode lottery for people with learning disabilities, what they've reported in some respects, which I'll come to. But in general, people find the social care system complex and inflexible. It's hard to get into. and it often involves multiple retellings of same experiences, and these experiences are often traumatic, so retelling them is difficult. If you enter the system as an adult, it's difficult to find out who to speak to and how to get an assessment, and that's complicated if someone doesn't have a formal diagnosis of having a learning disability, which is often the case. If you go into it as a child, in other words, if you have social care as a child, and then you move into the adult system, that's really difficult, really complicated, very frustrating for people. A lot of them describe the experience like falling off the edge of a cliff, because the level of service provision as an adult is often so much less than what children with learning disabilities are entitled to. But it's always going to be a complicated process because so many different agencies are involved. But the coordination of those agencies is just regularly very poor. And between the agencies, there's no clarity about who should be leading the process, and how wide the process should be. So that's one issue. Eligibility is another issue. Over the years, over the last few years, eligibility criteria have really tightened and become increasingly high, so that unless you're in critical or life-threatening need, you're just not eligible for social care, and it's currently a binary system. So you get it if you're in critical need, or you get nothing. There's a great quote in the Feely report saying someone with a learning disability saying that social care should be a springboard and not a safety net. But the springboard function of social care isn't working. There's a focus on crisis prevention and not on capacity building and not on protection of human rights. And one area that you could particularly describe as being a postcode lottery is social care charging, where some people pay almost nothing and some people pay really exorbitant amounts who receive similar levels of social care support. High turnover of staff's really problematic, and that's been particularly bad since the pandemic. The importance of relationships within social care is really high, and it's just getting harder and harder for people who use support, people with disabilities, to have a strong relationship with someone because the turnover is so quick. And finally, and this isn't what people have told us themselves, but it's really clear that there's a lack of data about people with learning disabilities. If you want to know how many people with learning disabilities there are in Scotland, you can't. It's just the information's not there. If you want to know how many people with learning disabilities in Scotland are on a housing waiting list, you can't. There's no data. The Fraser of Allender Institute have recently highlighted the particular invisibility of people with learning disabilities in data collections in Scotland. And that just makes planning, service planning, impossible, and policy planning, if you don't know how many people your policies or your plans are going to affect or what their support needs are. It just makes it very, very difficult. And finally, I mentioned the experience of COVID and the pandemic. And I think many people have experienced not returning to similar levels of support provision that they had pre-pandemic. And I think there's a number of reasons for that, but just in terms of people's life experience, it's been awful to the extent of making people feel suicidal. That's both people with learning disabilities and family carers where there are family carers involved.
Thank you very much, Andy, for that. And I believe, Sophie, you would like to come in on these questions as well.
Yes, thank you very much. And I'm going to echo a little bit of what Stephanie and Andy said, because I know similar experiences for our members. But just for a bit of context, so Glasgow Disability Alliance has a membership of more than 5,500 diverse disabled people with different outlooks on many, many things. But this is one area we have a completely unanimous position that the social care system in its current form is too broken and fragile meet the real needs of disabled people in Glasgow and across Scotland. So members of our social care expert group, over 100 disabled people in Glasgow who dedicate their time and energy on campaigning to improve the social care system for themselves and others, have gone months and in some cases over a year without a shower, have been called lazy by their care workers for asking for help, are put to bed while it's still light outside. Like Stephanie was saying, they are met with extremely long waiting periods for assessments, some waiting months or again years for urgent intervention. We know again that eligibility criteria is set too highly and is based around reducing dependency on services. And disabled people, we've found, don't feel believed or listened to by social care providers, and that trust has really broken down. Within our membership itself, 83% of members receiving social care support have reported that they do not get the support they need when they need it. And as others have touched on as well, we're facing this high turnover of care staff due to poor wages, poor progression and opportunities, which disabled people also object to and sympathise with. But for them, it means inconsistency, it means no-shows, it means cuts to care, which, as people have already pointed out, has a devastated impact, often on mental health and is a life or death situation. And to touch on the second question, there is definitely an inconsistency we've found between, but also within local authorities. So we've heard a lot of members talking about it's all about who you get. I mean, some people on the same street, one has had a brilliant experience of social care and one has had a really traumatising, difficult experience. We've also found that many GDA members have moved local authority just for the hope of finding better care in a different area. That's how stark the postcode lottery is. We're seeing the really real consequences for that amongst our membership. And just a final point, and I know this was touched on previously, there's also this assumption that when statutory provision is failing, that families can provide care to fill in the gaps, which changes relationships. It often puts families into poverty, and with the inadequate care support in place, it's a real difficulty for families financially and emotionally. So from our perspective, we are seeing that we are in the midst of a social care crisis that requires urgent intervention along all those points.
Thanks very much for that, Sophie. And Mike, I believe you would like to come in as well.
Yes, good morning, folks. Yeah, I mean, I very much echo a lot of what's been said by, you know, the other contributors. I mean, from my national perspective in relation to mental health, access to social care is very disparate and at times very desperate for people. You know, with my Granite Care Consortium hat on, this is someone that's responsible for taking forward possibly the biggest test of change in social care in Scotland, a whole place test of change in relation to the city of Aberdeen. You know, even in within single locations, you know, there is still a disparate picture that faces people trying to access social care. You know, we only have to look at the sizes of the unmet need lists and the waiting lists for people to get on to social care, but not only get on to social care, to get a social care assessment. You know, so in relation to the question, you know, is there a postcode lottery? Yes, I'd agree there is. And I agree that the situation is one that, when you look at, you know, locations, is still disparate in the sense that we have a disparate structure where we have, you know, three layers of provision and none of that quite ties up together. We've tried with IGBs and we've tried with SDS, and I know some of the questions later might come on to that, but, you know, as far as joined up thinking and joined up delivery is concerned, it just isn't there.
Thanks very, very much, Mike. And I'm going to continue with another question, and I'll actually start with you, Mike, and then if others want to come in, please indicate in the chat function. So the committee's heard from others that the proposed National Care Service is a disproportionate solution to some of the challenges that you have all laid out this morning. I'm keen to hear your views on whether legislation is needed to bring about the improvements, or is there another way that we could approach, you know, the more joined up needs or the things that you've discussed? Mike.
Yeah, I mean, back in, what was it, 2014, we tried to roll out IGBs. I remember sitting on a strategic planning group for IGBs in the city of Dundee at the time, and watched eight silos get reduced into four silos. and two of those silos staying within local authorities and two staying within health. And that was a, you know, some people's view of integration. You know, then what we had is we had SDS, which, you know, didn't quite achieve the person-centred focus that we believed it would have. You know, and you know, so for me, there was two pieces of legislation that they should have brought more integrated approaches to the, you know, delivery of social care. So, you know, those legislative pieces of, you know, social care haven't been successful. So I would argue that, you know, the legislative route is possibly the only route that's left open to us to try and actually create something that is truly integrated and truly creates a voice for the people that uses that use the services and for all the organisations that deliver those services. I mean, we only have to look at Granite Care Consortium and what we've tried to achieve in the city of Aberdeen within our first 2 years of operation. You know, and that's an example, and it is, there are pockets of really good practice across Scotland where we have seen attempts to create social integration and social care integration, and GCC is one of those. But that's taken the goodwill of people, and it's taken, you know, social care, you know, partnerships making a choice and making a decision and taking a gamble, you know, and you know, that's just one off. You know, if we should really have something similar to that, delivering services across the whole of Scotland, rather than relying on getting the right people around the table. We need a framework that will get the right people around the table to make that happen across Scotland, and for me, that would be a legislative framework.
Thanks, Mike. And Sophie would like to come in as well.
Yes, thank you very much. Just to echo what Mike said, I know that a lot of GDA members feel the same way, that it is the only route, that legislative change is the only route out of the current crisis that we're in. We believe that this change through legislation is needed, as well as in conjunction with increased resources and support to leaders driven by political buy-in. We know legislation can't change anything alone, but we know that this is needed to start making a change for the social care system to become fit for purpose. We know, especially because of the changes proposed in Derek Feely's independent adult review of social care, he said himself that legislative change is needed on a national level to put this progressive reform into place to fix all the problems that we've laid out earlier. From our perspective, GDA members feel like we need accountability at a national level, consistency, better standards to ensure disabled people's needs are actually met, and we think we need legislative backup to ensure this is actually implemented in the social care system. However, we would say the legislation as it stands does need more commitment, particularly in secondary legislation, to ensure that a human rights approach to social care is actually implemented and that change is properly put through. And that includes more detail on accountability, the charter and care board formation, which must have representation from disabled people's organisations and other collective voices to make sure that is carried through.
Stephanie, I think you want to come in, and then Andy.
Thank you. I'm going to take a slightly different view to the others, who have all pointed out that we've had an awful lot of legislation in the space of integration, starting with the Self-Directed Support Act, the Public Bodies Joint Working Act. You know, and Audit Scotland has examined much of the integration process, and there are numerous Audit Scotland reports. I would argue that this legislation hasn't been implemented, and people haven't been held to account where they haven't implemented. I think, you know, the other thing is we have national standards and guidance. So just in my area, for neurological conditions, we have the Framework for Action for Neurological Conditions, which covers acute community health and care. We have the Health Improvement Scotland General Standards for Neurological Care and Support. There are guidelines for individual conditions. Some of them are SPICE guidelines, for example, with epilepsy. But where SPICE guidelines don't exist, there are NICE guidelines. So, for example, for children with CP and adults with CP. And we have frameworks like GERFECT and Ready to Act for AHP's national framework. None of these seem to be being implemented or known about by the wider health and social care workforce. There are the answers to what we want are in these bits of legislation, but people are not being held to account for implementing them. So I had an example of a very large health and social care integrated joint board contact Cerebral Palsy Scotland, asking us in response to a complaint from a family of an adult with CP, was there any framework for the care of people with cerebral palsy? I was absolutely shocked that they didn't know that these documents existed and they weren't working towards them. It's not rocket science, and the answers, I would argue, are there. I would agree with previous speakers that we do have a problem with workforce. So, you know, we would call for a national workforce strategy, and we have a problem with data and invisibility. As a, you know, previous witnesses have said, it's not just people with learning disabilities that we don't know about. We don't know how many people there are with neurological conditions in Scotland. We don't know how many people there are with cerebral palsy. And we don't know how many unpaid family carers there are, frankly, backing up the system and being the safety net when we want the system to be a springboard.
Thanks very much, Stephanie. And Andy.
Yeah, I suppose there's two questions. One is legislation helpful? And the second question is the bill as it was consulted on earlier this year, is that the right legislation? I think what is clear is that change is needed. We think that some legislation would be helpful to increase accountability, perhaps to make national accountability would be helpful in terms of implementation. But we also agree with a lot of what Stephanie has said. There's already a whole raft of different legislation which it just isn't being implemented, and other policy frameworks which just aren't being implemented. And if we are particularly disappointed that the self-directed support legislation just has not brought about the change that we all hoped for. And if that hasn't worked, why should the National Care Service legislation? We were very disappointed with the bill that came out earlier this year, the National Care Service bill, because it focused solely on the structure of the new service and didn't give any assurance to us that that structure would bring about the human rights protections and the capacity building and the possibility for early intervention approaches that were put forward by Feely. And we were particularly disappointed by the financial memorandum, which explicitly excluded certain of the key building blocks in Feely's vision for a new national care service. And the costs in the financial memorandum were big enough. And I think that's really worrying at this point in time, with so many other financial pressures on the Scottish Government, is this the right time to be bringing in expensive new legislation? But even worse than that, the memorandum didn't cover a fraction, or only covered a fraction, of the real costs that will be needed to implement Feely's vision for a human rights protecting national care service, because it doesn't cost in. The financial memorandum I'm talking about, it doesn't cost in meeting current unmet demand, investing in community-based services, covering the loss of care charges, if these are to be abolished, and they cost £1.3 billion back in 2013. So we're talking about massive amounts of money, implementing new minimum terms and conditions for workers, the cost of new structures, for example, if there's going to be a social care commissioner, the cost of that office, the investment in independent advocacy services, which will be needed and which Philly talked about. None of those are costed in the financial memorandum, and it's going to be a huge, huge cost. And the worry is, if you just pay for the structure, it'll still be expensive and it won't bring about any of the outcomes that people with learning disabilities and other people that rely on local care support are hoping for from this new service.
Thanks, Andy. I just want to come back on a supplementary there, maybe both to you and Stephanie, because you brought up the fact that there is already existing legislation. And Andy, you've just been talking about the cost of bringing the National Care Service. And I just so we've got existing legislation and we've got reports from Audit Scotland and aspects of existing legislation hasn't been acted on. And I'd just love to hear a little bit more about why you think that's not happened. And is that to do with lack of funding in part? Maybe if I can start with Stephanie.
Yes, I think there are issues with the current setup. So, for example, I think a lot of it's to do with confusion about who is responsible for what. So, you know, there are issues with health boards, local authorities, IJBs and HSCP boundaries not being coterminous, and confusion around who does what. There is still, you know, we find people with cerebral palsy, particularly, who are not in receipt of big packages, if they present because they want some help to, I don't know, access employment or something like that, you know, they're being faced with, well, the reason you can't do that is because of your cerebral palsy, excuse me, and, you know, if you want that treated, you need to go to your GP, you know, and where is primary care in all of this? The lack of sharing of information amongst agencies is leading to confusion. And as I say, the lack of confusion around who is responsible, I think, is one of the reasons that the current system is an issue.
Thank you very much. Andy, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, lack of coordination and clarity, but also financial pressures on local bodies, on local authorities and HSCPs, and health boards as well, I suppose. So taking SDS as a specific example, I think there's a kind of crossover period. It's one of these bits of legislation where you would hope that, because it's putting forward a person-centred system of support, that if when that's in place, it's a very efficient system. People's needs are being met, and there's no kind of fat in the system. It's streamlined and so on. But to get to that point, requires going through a process that maybe does take extra investment that wasn't provided. And there is a lack of accountability. There just is, you know. I'm not saying that any individual or any one HSCP takes a so what attitude, but if it fails, if SDS fails in any one particular health and social care partnership, there's no repercussions really, except for the individuals and their families.
Okay, thanks very much for that.
I would always put forward an improvement programme. I'm not saying that we need to go around punishing health and social care partnerships or chief execs or anything. You know, improvement and learning from good practice is always much better. But what I'm just saying, there's no repercussions for failure.
Thanks very much for that. And I think one of the things that comes to my mind is that part of the reason the Minister talked about the NCS being brought forward was to put accountability at the door of ministers. So I guess that would be part of why it would be being brought in. I'm now going to move to bring in Willie Coffey with a few questions. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener, and hello to the panel online. I suppose I really have to start by asking you, do you actually see the National Care Service proposal as being the legislative instrument that can help to transform these services and to deliver the consistency that I think I'm hearing you saying that we need across Scotland. So that, I mean, there was a number of issues that you raised there, Andy, and everybody really, which outline a huge number of problems and experiences right across Scotland. So do you see the National Care Service proposal bill as being that instrument to help deliver that, or don't you? Could I maybe start with Sophie?
Yeah, thank you very much. So just to touch on what was said previously by Stephanie, I do think that the National Care Service does offer a solution, if done correctly, to some of the issues that were highlighted. So if you're talking about people not knowing who's responsible for what across local delivery, there not being consistent communication, if a national system was brought in the right way, with better consistency, national standards, accountability, then hopefully this would help to resolve those problems. And I think from our perspective, we think the National Care Service does provide an opportunity to make the progressive change needed to actually give disabled people the support they need to live the lives they want to live. I think it is an opportunity for radical change. From a GDA perspective, a lot of our members have said in response to the bill that the system as it stands can't get any worse. It can't get any worse than not being able to shower for months on end, or being told that you cost too much money or are too difficult for needing support to have your basic needs met. So for them, despite the bill not having everything we'd like to see at this stage, and we would like to see secondary legislation that really drills down on making sure there is a charter that's representative of our rights, that gives honour to the UNCRPD and the right to independent living, that gives more detail about care boards and making sure there's representation of disabled people and disabled people's organisations on those care boards, and making sure that accountability is specified and how that would be oversaw on a local level to address the postcode lottery that was mentioned earlier. We think that despite the legislation that stands isn't perfect, we're hopeful that this and a National Care Service would give rise to a new system with proper legislative backup that could stop the human rights breaches that we're seeing at the moment and to give disabled people the support they need.
Thanks, Sophie. Could I turn to Andy, please? Same question, obviously.
Hi there. Legislation could help and could be it can be the answer on its own, but it could be part of the answer. Certain things would need to be put into place. The architects of the bill would need to focus on much more than just the structure. But as if the National Care Service wasn't complicated enough on its own, there are other bits of legislation currently being developed, which particularly will affect people with learning disabilities, for example, not just people with learning disabilities, but you've got the Human Rights Bill, you've got the Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill, and you've got the review of the mental health legislation. And it's complicated, but it's really important that these four bits of legislation are properly aligned. So, for example, the Human Rights Bill will place duties on states' parties to protect the rights of disabled people, for example, to live independently. So that's going to impact on the National Care Service. And the Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill will establish a commissioner, almost certainly, and that commissioner might have a role to play in the scrutiny and accountability of how the National Care Service is delivered. So that's why the teams developing these four different bits of legislation really need to know what each other is saying. And at the moment, I'm not sure that's happening as well as it needs to be. It's a highly complex task. I'm not minimising that in any way. I think four bits of legislation together could well make a difference, particularly around accountability, but they do need to align and help each other or not get in each other's way.
Mike, is the National Care Service Bill the instrument that we need to deliver that consistency of care across Scotland, in your opinion?
Morning, Willie. I would argue, if not, then what? And if not now, when? I mean, we have a system that in my 30-odd years nearly in health and social care, from a social work perspective, people tell me is broken, and I witness it on a daily basis. I don't meet anybody in the field that doesn't tell me that change is required. You know, and if we look at some of the previous legislation that my colleagues have all talked about very well this morning, and we take SDS as an example and look at that from a kind of case study perspective, you know, we're still delivering that on a time and task basis, you know, and we desperately need to move to an outcomes focus where we can actually start to work alongside people and measure the outcomes that they needed, you know, in relation to their package of care, and that needs to have a human rights basis to that. You know, and the test of change we're trying to take forward, Granite Care Consortium in Aberdeen, you know, we're the only whole place test of change in the country, and we're trying to bring all of those things together. And even then, we're still facing, you know, large unmet needs. We're looking at how you risk assess that unmet need. You're looking at how you risk assess the people that you deliver that care and support to. And we're doing that within a system at the moment that's disparate, you know, because you have health sitting at one part of that equation, you have local authority in-house or long-arm care providers as another element, you have the third and independent sector as another element, and we have successfully brought all of those together in this test of change. Now, I would argue that that's a forerunner to what Derek Feely was trying to describe, you know, within the Feely report, and that's what I believe that legislation and an NCS could help us create. So for me, you know, I do believe that this is the time for legislation, and if we don't grasp the opportunity now, you know, we will end up tinkering with something that's broken and just end up with another patch-up job on a system that needs to be integrated.
Right, just lastly, Stephanie, is it the instrument that we need to address the issues that you yourself mentioned there about, you know, policy frameworks not being implemented all over the place? So will the National Care Service proposal help us to garner that together and deliver the outcomes that we all seek, do you think?
I think the short answer to that is, given the outline of the proposed bill, it's difficult to see where that would be. We absolutely welcome the drive to ensure consistency of social work and of social work and social care services, but we're wary of too much centralisation. And if the establishment of the National Care Service is just another layer of bureaucracy that service users have to navigate, then no, it won't improve quality. I've already mentioned that there are national standards, and we need national standards, and we need to hold people to account for implementing them. But services are local. Services are delivered locally. And I just want to read an organisation called Social Care Futures' definition of the purpose of social care, which is, we all want to live in a place we call home with the people and things we love, in communities where we look out for one another, doing what matters to us. So this bill seems to start with the structure and the formality at the top. I would argue we need to start with the person and those around the person and build up. And this bill doesn't do that. And that is why local is so vital. And, you know, you have to remember that community assets, third sector organisations can support people who don't need formal regulated care services at the moment to find appropriate support without drawing on formal services. And that underpins all the formal structures that we see in the National Care Service Bill at the moment. So I'm very disappointed by this bill, and I'm not convinced it's going to deliver the change that all of us want to see.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Stephanie. I just have another question. I would be really grateful for maybe a simple yes-no from our panellists. It's really on the accountability question. You heard the Minister last week saying he fields questions very often in the Parliament, and he doesn't have any accountability for many of the issues that are raised and put to him. Simply and shortly, could you say whether you agree that national accountability is needed at ministerial level? or not, and I'd really appreciate a simple yes-no in order to let other colleagues come in with their questions. Andy, maybe first.
Yes.
Thank you. Sophie?
Yes.
Thank you. Mike, is Mike still... Mike? Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. And lastly, Stephanie.
Why isn't the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care not accountable at the moment?
The legislation doesn't point in that direction, I'm afraid. It's local accountability. I mean, there is accountability here, Stephanie.
But he is the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care.
Yeah, but he isn't legally responsible. It's the local councils and IAGBEs and so on that are responsible, and that's where the accountability currently lies, and that's why we get the disparate position we're in, perhaps. So... do you think he should be accountable or not?
Yes.
Good, thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you, Willie. And just so we do have quite a few questions to go through. I would ask colleagues to direct their question to somebody initially. And for folks on the panel, put an R in the chat function if you have something to add. So that we can make sure we get through. I definitely want to hear from everybody, but if we keep going around everyone for all the questions, we are going to run over time quite considerably. So I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener. And maybe in the purpose of time, I'll do some yes-no questions as well, because another committee, the Social Justice Committee, has been looking specifically at this, at the National Care Service Bill as well, and part of our work has been around the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities, which will be created. Now, I welcome that, but one of the concerns is that that is not necessarily going to be legally binding. So I wanted to ask the witnesses whether or not you think it should be, and we can do a yes-no answer round as well. So I don't know if I'll start with Stephanie and work round.
I'm going to give you a cautious yes.
Thanks.
Mike?
Yes.
Sophie?
Yes.
And Andy?
Cautious yes, but can I add,
sure,
that I really... sorry, but can, it's a plea to separate rights and responsibilities from the Charter. It should be a Charter of Rights, because the rights we're talking about are human rights and they're not conditional.
Yeah.
And when you link rights and responsibilities, that's suggesting that people are entitled to their rights as long as they behave responsibly in a certain way.
Yeah.
So, of course, it may be the case that people that use support have responsibilities to behave in a certain way, but that should not, there should not be any suggestion that folk might not be entitled to the human rights if they behave badly.
Yeah, no, thank you, and that's a very good point. The Health and Social Care Alliance has suggested there should be scope within the bill for the creation of an independent authority to hold ministers to account, as we've been discussing, for their decisions. So I also wanted to ask the panel what their view is on that and whether or not they support that call as well. So I'll maybe bring you back in, Stephanie, on that go round.
I think that the problem with the current bill is that there's no detail and structure. So it's really difficult to understand from the vague text. You know, it talks about Scottish ministers being held accountable for, quote, securing improvement in the well-being of the people of Scotland. That's a massive thing. And I really don't know, if I was trying to draw up the KPIs for that, how you would hold ministers into account. So I think... my problem is that we need to see clear lines of responsibility, both locally and nationally. And if the only accountable officer is a government minister, then I would argue that that is too far removed from everyday experience of individuals. I don't know whether I want to come in here that I think a lot of this could be solved by the right to independent advocacy and mediation at an earlier stage. And I would call for that to be integral.
Does anyone else want to come in? No?
No.
Otherwise, thanks very much.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Miles. We're now going to move to Marie McNair, who is a colleague who's joining us online. Marie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you for your time this morning. I've got a few questions.
What have been the impacts of the integrated joint boards, and has this model had enough time to bed in and make a difference? What are the implications of replacing them with the care boards? And I know you've touched on them already, and just wanted to know if you'd maybe like to comment further. And I'll pop that first to Mike Burns, if that's okay.
Morning, Marie.
Morning.
As someone who was, as I said earlier, part of the strategic planning and development of IGBs, back in 2014-15, looking back onto it from a third sector and private sector, independent sector perspective, we ended up in some ways with a power grab, and really the voice of people, who receive those services, in my opinion, was not reflected in the establishment of IGBs. And you only have to look at IGBs across Scotland to see that in some IGBs we have third and independent sector representation, in others we don't. But the legislative framework around that, wasn't robust enough to ensure, an equal voice at IGBs. So my own opinion is that IGBs have not succeeded in their mission and vision. And hopefully if we do establish an NCS with care boards, that care boards would learn from that and address some of the deficits that we have around IGBs.
Thank you, Mike. Does anyone else want to further comment? I know a lot of it has been touched already.
It doesn't look like anyone else is going to come in on that.
Okay. The next question, again, it's been covered, but I'd say, but do you recognise that obviously the situation expressed by the Minister last week? Obviously, you're saying currently people feel that they're pushed from pillar to post if they can have a complaint or concerns. And I know a lot of that's been discussed already, but just throw that out there if anybody wants to kind of expand on that further. Just pop it to Sophie, sorry to put you on the spot, but do you want to comment?
Yeah, absolutely. So there is a massive inconsistency, and we see recurring examples of GDA members being pushed from pillar to post constantly, particularly when they're navigating the different areas that people like Stephanie were highlighting that don't join up. So going from SDS to an OT assessment, there's a lot of lack of transparency about what support is available. And particularly for GDA members, there's not accessible information about what support is available. Sometimes they're speaking to people within social work that themselves don't even know what is available. And then they're then referred to community navigators or people within our own organisation to give them advice further. So we'd hope in an NCS having that kind of national consistency of information, a bit more transparency about what services are available would help with that. Within our own organisation, as part of our Future Visions project, we have been testing a community navigator model, which is essentially a person that works with some a disabled person as a holistic person and looks at their needs holistically and takes them through all the aspects they need in social care and does that work for them, because we're finding that people either aren't able to navigate that system and all the complex different people they need to go to when they're pushed from door to door, but also there's not the accessible support there through advocacy and a complaints process that isn't local, that's all internal to help them through that journey.
Thank you, Sophie. Anyone else want to come in quickly?
Yes, so Stephanie and Mike both want to come in.
Yep. Stephanie?
Thank you. I just want to address complaints specifically, because in seeking to nationalise a complaint service, we worry that local accountability could be lost. Our experience shows that too often the only way people who currently experience inadequate care and support can seek change is to make a formal complaint. And when they do, they are passed from pillar to post with professionals trying to justify why they've done what they've done, rather than seeking to understanding the motivation for why the complaint has been brought in the first place, and therefore seek a remedy. So we would like service users and service providers to be provided at the earliest possible stage to an opportunity to work together to resolve these issues, rather than than having to go down the route of using a complaint service, which might take lots of time and might resolve absolutely nothing. So in our opinion, access to advocacy and mediation services should be a first step available to all service users. We note that
Section 13 states that Scottish ministers may make provision for independent advocacy services. There is a lottery as to which condition you are able to access advocacy services or not. So, for example, people with a learning disability at the moment have a statutory right. People without a learning disability don't. We call on the government to make right to access of independent advocacy for people with cerebral palsy and their carers, and we'd like the clause amended to read Scottish ministers will, by regulations, make provision for independent advocacy services. I really support Sophie's navigators. I think they are an under-championed role, but I would say one of the issues that we have, and this is an absolute fundamental issue of integration, is that when you look at people's needs in a social care holistic life, comes into, and cerebral palsy is a really good example of that, that what they need to stay well, maybe, for example, is physiotherapy, that's immediately seen as a health issue. And then you're down another route, and, you know, people's access to physiotherapy is the same, you know, it's the same starting blocks again, rather than that being seen as an enabler, like maybe perhaps we might use regular exercise or, you know, a gym membership or something like that. So there is a lack of understanding about what input for people's condition is going to make the biggest difference.
Thank you, Stephanie. No worries, it's sort of pressed for time, but I think Mike's wanting to come in, and Andy, be brief if possible.
Yeah, definitely, Maria. One of the successes we've achieved in the whole city test to change in Aberdeen is that in relation to these issues, we have social care managers, social work social care managers, and service providers working alongside each other, doing risk assessments. And those risk assessments are often ways of preventing some of the complaints coming forward. And by that joint integrated working, you know, the number of complaints we receive or the number of issues we have to deal with have been greatly reduced. So there's just one example of what we think Derek Feely is talking about and we've made happen in that test of change.
Thank you. And finally, Andy.
Well, very quick points. One is that a lot of people with learning disabilities have said that they don't know what standard of care or support they're entitled to expect. And so they don't know whether to make a complaint or not if they're unhappy. So we think there should be a national part of the National Care Service work should be to have a national programme to communicate people's human rights and rights to receive support that meets the health and social care standards. And also to echo what Stephanie was saying about the lack of independent advocacy, and research that we carried out a few years ago showed that it was inconsistent and insufficient across the country. And investment in advocacy is mentioned in the financial memorandum.
Thank you, Andy. No further questions, convener.
Thanks, Marie. And I'm just going to remind us all again that it would be good if we can keep our questions and answers succinct. And if members can direct the question to one person to start, and again, if panel witnesses can just put an R in the chat to indicate if you really have something additional to add. Mark Griffin.
Thanks, convener. There have been concerns from trade unions and local authorities about a potential wholesale transfer of staff and assets to a new directorate, essentially. But I think the minister's kind of set out a different direction of travel when he was at committee and said that would only be any transfer of assets or staff would only be as a provider of a last resort in the event of a care home or a service failure. I just wanted to ask, what's the current situation in terms of provider of last resort, and how would the National Care Service change that in the terms of how the minister set that out? And perhaps come to Mike first.
Morning. I say GCC is a really good example of that, because in the city of Aberdeen we had one provider of last resort, and that was the local authority in-house provider, Mark. You know, now we have GCC, which is a consortium of independent and third sector organisations, you know, delivering to the whole city. In fact, you know, delivering to, you know, almost three times that's being delivered by the local authority and house provider, as also the provider of last resort. And I know the big, big question that's being asked around this potential transfer is the question around, you know, pensions and such, you know, but you have a three-tier structure at the moment. And I would ask that we have to look at that three-tier structure and understand that and do something about that if we want to provide, you know, a balanced and equal delivery of care across Scotland. We have National Health Service staff being paid out of that one pot of money. We have local authority care staff being paid out of that pot of money. And we have third and independent sector organisations being paid out of that pot of money. And I hate to say this, all being paid differently, but delivering exactly the same standard of services. And as Feely pointed out, some of the best care that was being delivered is being delivered by the third sector. But so there is a disparate position there that we have to address. And I do take on board some of the concerns about the transfer of those staff, but there are ways to look at that, and we've proved in GCC that actually there's other ways to achieve that outcome.
Thanks, Mike. I don't know if there's anyone else.
So Stephanie would like to come in.
Thank you. I just want to say that in reality, the answer to this question is that family, friends, unpaid carers are the real providers of last resort. They are unidentified, they are invisible, and they are unsupported. When things fail, families are made to feel an obligation to step in. So the example of that is during the pandemic, when many disabled adults had to move back into elderly parents' homes because they couldn't access community support to live independently. Family and unpaid carers are not treated as equal partners in the care of their loved ones. Often they are not listened to by professionals and they are not supported to navigate the system. Yes, in theory, there are support networks. So there are local carer centres, GPs, for example, but some people do not class themselves as carers and therefore don't access the support. So I just think that in answer to your question about who is the carer of last resort? In reality, every day it is family and unpaid carers.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks for that. My second question was in the report, the Review of Adult Social Care reported, and I'm quoting, that trust is not currently in plentiful supply in social care support. I just wonder if Wanties agree with that, whether they feel that that is the same situation when it comes to National Health Service provision, and if not, why there might be a disparity between trust being there and social care, not being there in social care, but being there in a health setting. Perhaps could come to Sophie first.
Thank you. I would agree that definitely there's a lack of trust in the current system as it stands. I think that's for a variety of reasons. I think, especially after COVID, if we look at cuts that happened in Glasgow alone, 1,884 social care packages were cut in Glasgow from the outset of lockdown, some being partially reinstated, but a lot haven't been reinstated at all. People have been, for the last 2.5 years, faced extreme isolation, poverty, cuts to vital services. Even before COVID, during austerity, we saw policies in Glasgow, such as equalisation, which was essentially cutting social care packages of disabled people and saying this is being done to equalise, so your neighbour down the road will get something, and cutting their vital services to justify it. So in that context of cuts and not feeling heard or listened to, and as I cited previously, people going massive amounts of time without essential support, being asked to choose between having a shower and eating that day because their carers are so pressed for time. In that context, it is really difficult for people to have a trust in the systems it stands. And I think that is why national change is really required, because say if you were to co-design something at a local level, the trust to do that and to engage with people isn't there, because people have seen what's happened in the past and they are aware that even with all these policy changes, for example, maximising independence, which I won't get into for time's sake, but all these new policies that have come in that have done nothing for disabled people, they don't have faith in the system as it stands. So having a new national system where it is based on co-design, it is making an effort to take that lived experience into account, it offers this new hope that it might be a better system than what we have at the moment.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Sophie. We're now going to move to questions from Paul McClellan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. You'd be glad to know that I've only got the one. I think the second one's kind of been answered. But probably you're bearing in mind this is obviously a framework document, and the next stage really is moving to the co-design and co-production process and part of that. I suppose it's really just asking about how you would like to see that process involve yourselves going forward. The Minister's already committed to working with those with lived experience. And I'll probably come to yourself first of all, Mike, just on that one.
Yeah, I think that's critical. I think co-design and co-production, you know, have to be a central tenet of how we take forward the NCS, Paul, and how we do that. Well, again, I'll go back to the example we have in Aberdeen, where we are delivering services to people with learning difficulties, older people, personal care, mental health, you know, and we're working in partnership with the Health and Social Care Partnership and all the other providers within the city. You know, so for me, it's about having that conversation, and you start that conversation with the people you deliver the services to, and they need to be an important part of that conversation. So what we had in Aberdeen is we have a co-design and you have a collaboratively commissioned concept. And for me, that's the central tenet of what Derek Feely was saying.
Okay, Mike, thank you for that. I don't know if anybody else wants to come on that one. I think it's a really important part, I think, of the process moving forward. We've talked about the framework, as I said, the next stage. I don't know, Sophie, and anybody can come in, everybody can come in. I think it's a really important part of the process, if it's okay.
Yeah, Andy has indicated, and also Stephanie.
Hi there. Yeah, I agree that co-design is really critical going forward. It's really heartening to see the commitment to co-design from the NCS team. In practice, I think it's very challenging to make that properly inclusive, and I think it's making sure that people with learning disabilities are included in the co-design process is challenging, but really, really important. The structures have been set up for co-design. For example, they've set up lived experience panels for people that use social care support, but our concern is that that's not an accessible model for people with learning disabilities. So I think we just need to keep the conversation open, and the NCS team needs to keep listening to what's working for people with lived experience to make sure that they are properly involved all the way through. The main point I really wanted to make is that the timescales are artificially short. There's a commitment to get this legislation through in this parliamentary term, and I don't think that's going to compromise the effectiveness of the co-design. And for people who take a bit longer to make their contribution, they're going to be cut out. That's our fear.
Oh, Andy, thank you.
Thanks, Andy, and Stephanie, and then Sophie.
Well, apart from associating myself with everything that Andy has just said, our concern is that this process is the wrong way round.
Stephanie, it's moving. I think we kind of heard the evidence. I suppose in the short time we have, it's more on the focus around about what you would like to see your involvement in the process, because I think we've heard evidence of that. But again, conscious of the time, where you see your involvement in the co-design process.
Then, in the interest of time, I will just absolutely echo what Andy said. Timescales, and it's not fully, the lived experience panels and things are not fully inclusive in, you know, and representative.
Okay, well, maybe I'll maybe take that up with you after that. Sophie
wanted to come in.
Yes, just very briefly, I'd again echo everything that Stephanie and Andy has said, and I think co-design is really, really important, particularly as we go into secondary legislation. It does take time and resources, but I think it's a really, really valuable and important step. And I know people touched on lived experience panels. From our perspective, making sure that there is a collective voice guiding that, so using state people organisations that have that mandate to speak to the process of co-design and have that capacity building built into the process to make the participation more meaningful.
Okay, Sophie, thank you. No further questions come in.
Thanks very much, Paul. And that does bring us to the end of our questions. So thanks so much for keeping the answers short. Stephanie, I noticed that you were cut off in something that maybe was important to convey to the committee. So if you'd like to put that in writing, I would welcome that. And so thank you so much for joining us this morning. I think it's been very useful for the committee to hear from all of you and hear the different perspectives. And I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. We'll now begin our second panel of witnesses this morning. On panel two, we're joined in person by Adam Stachura, who is the head of policy and communications at Age Scotland. I maybe mispronounced your last name there. And online, we've been joined by Henry Simmons, who's the Chief Executive of Alzheimer's Scotland, and Hannah Tweed, who is the Senior Policy Officer from the Health and Social Care Alliance. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. If you can, for those who are online, if you can indicate if you want to respond by putting an R in the chat box, I'll make sure that we bring you in. But also, we will direct questions, members will direct questions to somebody specifically to start off. So I'd like to begin, and I'm going to direct my first question to Hannah. And actually, this might be one where we get the response from all of you. So I'd be interested in hearing what the main problems with the way social care is currently delivered, and an add-on to that, do you agree that there's currently a postcode lottery in care delivery? Hannah?
Short answer is yes. I think that, as was ably covered by the previous panel participants, there's a wide variety of evidence available about the ways in which condition-specific and area-specific delivery of care varies, irrespective, in many cases, of actual need, which is what that should be grounded in. We have a variety of material from work the Alliance has done in partnership with Self-Directed Support Scotland around people's experiences of accessing SDS and social care in Scotland, and that really highlighted the range of that variance. I would say that some areas have notably poorer access, so I'd highlight folk with lived experience of sensory loss, mental health problems, people with learning disabilities, as Andy mentioned. And part of that is reinforced by both care charging and eligibility criteria use of Scotland. I think there's also something about information sharing informing that. So we found when we did the My Support, My Choice project I mentioned, that only 42% of respondents found that social workers described all four options with them in reviews. So part of this is grounded in, if social workers are not empowered to have the information to share, people are not going to have the suitable choice. It may not be the best provision of care for them. And that's before you get into the T's and C's of specific problems with individual providers in some areas. And I'll pause there because there's a lot more that I'm sure colleagues can speak to.
Thank you, Hannah. Adam, what about you? What do you think?
Well, I think, as ever, Hannah has done a very good job of summing up exactly the position. There is a significant challenge. We hear at Age Scotland from older people and their families and carers about the delivery of social care, and it's not been new. It's not been something which has occurred as a result of COVID-19. In fact, this was long since been the position. I think as a charity, we've been very careful not to use the phrase that social care is in crisis before COVID, but my goodness, it is now. I think you'd be very careful when you use that, because it can't keep getting a bigger crisis and a bigger crisis. And as we've heard in this last week from representatives in social care, that the system, in a sense, is potentially on the verge of falling over, with large closures on the card potentially for care homes. And that would be absolutely critical in terms of people's well-being. What happens then if people cannot live in their own home, which is their care home? That people will face incredibly long waits to receive, in the first instance, assessments for their social care, and secondly, to actually receive the package itself. You know, there was a very good series of FOIs from Helen Puttick at the Times at the beginning of this year, which she discussed with us, and it outlined some extraordinary waits of years that people were waiting to receive their social care package. And, you know, that the clock stops when you sort of get the first part of that piece. So for people still waiting 1,200 days in Perth and Kinross, outcomes for them are incredibly poor. So I think the answer to this is yes. But often, going back one step, at Age Scotland, we hear from people through our helpline and our different projects and on the ground, and we hear the worst of it, of course. There's a lot of great social care. I think members of the Scottish Parliament will hear this all the time. You'll have these delivered in your constituencies and regions. But there's a significant challenge on getting it, getting good quality care, getting enough of it. And actually, I think in the previous panel mentioned, when care has been reduced to meet budgetary needs or capacity needs, has meant the outcomes for that person are far, far poorer than they should be, particularly with regard to their own rights and their human rights.
Thanks for that. Henry, do you have anything to add there? We can't hear you at the moment. Hang on a minute. No. Not sure what's going on there. Maybe while you're trying to figure that out, I will. We can come back to you, and you can once we get your audio sorted out. But I'll just add my other question I had, which is that so the committee's heard. We've had evidence sessions already on the National Care Service, and we've heard from previous witnesses that. The bill, as proposed, is a disproportionate solution to the challenges that we face. I'm keen to hear your views on whether you think we actually need legislation to bring about the improvement. So maybe, Adam, I'll start with you.
I think we're at a position now where, you know, legislation, I mean, is what we've got. You know, I think if you look across the piece in social care, how disparate it can be in terms of the receipt of it, the different systems that will be in place. You know, we've talked in the past, and everyone has talked about those that hear from people who receive social care or their families about this postcode lottery idea. You know, we've got, you know, huge numbers of different kind of integrated joint boards, health social care partnerships, and how the NHS do this, and local authorities. I think this has been a helpful step, and if you're going to try and reform social care, then you probably need a useful mechanism to do that, and legislation will be this. And actually underpinning all of this is about accountability as much as anything, and responsibility for social care. I was listening to the last panel session there, and the question was put about, you know, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care actually having responsibility for that. Well, my goodness, that's exactly the type of thing I think we need from the Scottish Government. So it's not just in name only, social care, because if you go back to the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic and the instances of people's social care packages being removed from them, told that they will have to go without. People will be waiting days in their own beds without being fed or washed or anything, the things that they need. There was nobody really held accountable for that in a crisis. Now, while that wasn't a crisis, that demonstrated absolute necessity. The Scottish Government had no levers, essentially, to fix this. You know, local authorities or IJBs or health service partnerships were wholly remote from public accountability. And I think if you had that in the health system, which is equally as necessary to somebody's well-being as social care if you're receiving it. So I think underpinning that, having that responsibility is necessary, and actually trying to reform social care is important. That will mean many things to many different people, of course. A lot of this will be about money and resources and how this is used effectively, the best outcomes for people. So we've got a National Care Service proposed, and we wholeheartedly support such a thing, and at least in the broadest concept of it. But I want to bring that back to the accountability and responsibility is massively important, and doing so through legislation, as much as anything, is vital.
Thanks, Adam. Hannah, you've indicated you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I would agree with Adam's comments there. I would also say that I think there are parts of the system that we can be working on to improve out with the legislative framework, and that should be happening. But that's not a fix-all. We know that the structure of, say, the SDS legislation does not deal with the problems we have with eligibility criteria, which are one of the most pressing reasons why people don't receive early intervention care, why things reach the point of crisis intervention. I do use that word very specifically because I think that is frequently the case that people are in by the time they actually have access to social care in many instances now. I would also flag that although legislation isn't a fix in all ways, and I would particularly say that we, the Alliance and our membership, do have concerns about the framework bill approach. There are things we would really wish to see change in that for within primary legislation. More on that later. An example of legislative protections working well when there were problems with accountability would be during the pandemic. We know that some local authorities temporarily suspended complaint systems. Now, that's not in line with their duty as public bodies, and when that was raised,
I would assume out of ignorance and relative lack of support for extremely overworked individuals. I'm not trying to knock frontline local authority colleagues by saying this, but functionally they were not fulfilling their statutory duties. And when that was raised and aired with them, the problem was actually dealt with pretty promptly, because there was the legislative accountability and because there were processes in place to go, that's not great, and here's why. So to have something that can provide similar assurances, I think would be beneficial if done right, and that's a pretty significant codicil.
Thanks very much, Hannah. Henry, I'm going to try to bring you in again, and kind of if you can just respond or add anything to both the kind of question about from the Alzheimer's Scotland perspective, kind of the problems with the way that social care is delivered and the postcode lottery piece, but also do we actually need to bring in legislation to bring about the improvement?
Can I just check you can hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Fantastic.
I don't know what happened. Yes, apologies. Yeah, I think that in terms of I can answer the necessity question first of all, that there's no doubt, I think, that as a country we're still reeling from the changes that were made back in 1986, from the days of regional councils, and we've never really quite, I think, been able to deliver consistent variation across 32 local authorities of what effective social care. So our view is very much that when you're faced with the challenges of the scale of dementia, and if you look across the piece, everyone today has told you how difficult it is to access good quality social care. But I think what's more important is that there's some big strategic plans that have been made over the past 12 years, particularly around dementia, three national dementia strategies. There are around about probably 35 to 40 commitments, and all of them rely on local delivery. And very few of them, if any, have actually been delivered consistently. So I think I can understand this from two sides. I can understand when a local authority is dealing with their own issues and trying to work out how best to serve their communities and the challenges that they've got there. And then a government who puts together some of the best, perhaps the most comprehensive and innovative policies around dementia that we certainly think could be on the table. These two things don't weld well together. So we've got, you know, national visions, national strategies, national agreements that would transform the lives of people with dementia from the point of diagnosis through to integrated and advanced care that have never really been delivered. So when you ask us if that were under the governance and direction of a national care service with care boards that were working to a consistent framework to give everyone across the piece the same quality of care, we would say, yes, that makes an awful lot of sense, because what we have tried to do to date has just been very difficult. And I think that the IJBs, when you bring two struggling bodies together with very little funds to meet the needs that's already out there, I think that they're right at the start, they were about saving money and trying to make best use of resources. And we never reached the point about really meaningful prevention work. And I think that, you know, the thing that Derek Feely highlighted and we were very supportive of was the sense of moving forward, thinking about prevention, thinking about intervention earlier, and even at the time of crisis, that we need to really move everything forward and think through how we can avoid so much of the difficulties we experience now. And I think that's, again, something that needs to come from a national perspective, driven through care boards to local people.
Thanks very much. Now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much again, Convener, and good afternoon to everybody on the panel. I just wanted to go back to Derek Feely's report, of course, and one of the key standouts for me in there that I've read many times now is that Derek said there should be the driving focus should be consistency of quality and equity of care and support by service users. That's at the heart of the Feely review. Do you think, in your opinion, does the National Care Service provide the instrument to enable us to deliver this consistency of service across Scotland? And I'll ask Adam if he would pitch in with an answer to that, please.
I think it could. I think actually it could. Obviously, detail is lacking in a lot of the things, how it'll actually happen. Of course, it's being co-designed, there'll be co-production underlying the kind of secondary part of legislation. But I think that when you consider the lack of consistency, and that's highlighted by the fact that anyone is coming forward to say that they're having poor social care or not receiving it at all. And it's not meant at those who are delivering it, because actually look across the piece, if you're, for those who are working in social care, that consistency for them as well is lacking. As mentioned in the last panel about different terms and conditions for doing the same type of work, but depending on who's been commissioned to undertake this, that some suppliers or suppliers providers may have to withdraw entirely from delivering social care because financially it's not sustainable. And we've had before, you know, this latest round of energy crisis, care homes closing because of financial model, you know, it's an expensive business, care, and often good things cost money. But I think this is really important. Philo's absolutely right in that report. And I think if you look, go back in all of this about who requires care, not just now, but in the future, whether you're a child, whether you're an adult, whether you're an older adult, and as we've got an ageing population, every one of us who may need care would expect to have something that meets our needs, then that's it's absolutely right in this, and it's not consistent. So the care service could do all of these things. And devil will be in the detail, of course. And that's what we don't really have right now to be able to properly scrutinise.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that, Adam. Could I have a brief comment from Henry and from Hannah as well, please, on that? Is this the instrument that we need to deliver that consistency across the country?
Well, thanks for that. I think that the truth will be that there'll be variations in performance. So I think if you look across to our National Health Service, for example, we don't achieve consistency, despite having sort of a very clear directions and very clear guidance, and because performance is always an issue and there's management and there's lots. So I think that what we will have is a consistent set of principles, a consistent set of standards, a consistent set, hopefully, of rights and expectations that can be delivered and measured against. But I do think, given the challenges of running any social care structure of this scale, we'll always see some depth of inconsistency. But if you were to ask me about the values and the principles and the sort of driving position, yeah, we need a national care service that's got all of that at the front. That should determine the structures that come behind it, and then I think the performance and delivery will need an awful lot of very sort of like in-depth monitoring to ensure we achieve that consistency.
Thanks, Henry. Hannah?
I would echo Adam's conditional response and that of Henry as well, I think, if I can summarise it that way. I guess if I was getting into the T's and C's, I'd say the National Care Service has more organisational capacity potentially to do that in certain areas than current systems, but I'm not sure that that's the same thing as saying the National Care Service, brackets Scotland, close brackets Bill, does. So talking specifically, I know data collection came up during the last panel, particularly around problems with the flags used around vocal learning disabilities. Our national approach to data collection with proper intersectional analysis, both around different population groups and how they're accessing social care, and something outcomes focused that could be managed nationally so the same questions and the same data sets are being compared, and to highlight where things are working well and that practice is shared, as well as highlighting problems, I think could be a really key part of seeing the usefulness of some areas of national analysis alongside that local delivery part that is also very important and has been raised by colleagues. If you don't have that, you don't know what you don't know. You can't meet the problem. I would also say that although I would agree that there are clearly issues with varied provision within the NHS, the NHS does not vary its eligibility criteria in different local authorities, and social care does. So there are some areas where, under the current system, there are very clear distinctions in practice, and that bluntly, they are not human rights-based approaches by default. And the very welcome sections in Section 1 of the Bill, prioritising human rights-based approaches, could see that play through in a more equitable, in a more equal fashion. With more detail, please.
Okay, thanks for that, Hannah. Just another question that led the previous panel with. On the question of accountability, do you agree or not that ultimate accountability should rest with a cabinet secretary in the Scottish Government? Adam's nodding.
That means myself first.
Hannah. Okay, Hannah.
Sorry, I'd been left unmuted, so I wasn't sure. I think ministerial accountability is a good concept. I think that it is useful to be able to have not marking your own homework, if I can put it in those terms. Sometimes at the moment when people are submitting complaints, that we're hearing again and again that we're not sure who's dealing with it, the transparency isn't there, we don't know where to go if we haven't got anywhere. There's something that is more devolved, has its benefits. But we do also question the longevity of some of that and whether there also needs to be a system that ensures party political changeover does not affect people's access to accountability structures.
Okay. Henry?
Yes, I think it actually reflects what the public needs to be the case at the present time. I think if you look at probably ministers' inboxes, you'll see lots and lots of people writing to them asking for them to fix and solve all the issues and difficulties in social care. So I think the general public tend to think that the minister is responsible for social care. What I would say is that I think that the challenges of social care have been very difficult for many local authorities and IGIBs to deal with. So for me, this has to be about an inclusive engagement with everyone for this transition moving forward. And ultimately, I think that it's the right way to go. But I don't think it's simply because the current system can be really appalling. But I think the general public are keen for their government to be responsible for things that are most close to them.
OK. Thanks very much for that, Ruby. Convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. We're now going to move to a question from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us today. It's my understanding that Lord Brailsford, the new chair of the Scottish Public Inquiry into the handling of the COVID-19 pandemic, will meet with families today, and I welcome that. And I wanted to ask specifically, with regards to your organisations, whether or not you feel Anne's Law has actually been captured and embedded into the legislation. I'll maybe start with you, Adam.
I don't think that if you asked those who are initially calling for Anne's Law, I don't speak for them, to say, is this what we intended or what we needed, they would say it is. I think that it's also a pretty complicated business getting it with all the different elements that are required. We were really supportive of it, have been through the whole pandemic. The really sad thing in this is it's necessary at all that essentially people's human rights were not realised to do this. And what we didn't have often was a system in which people said, how can we make this happen? As opposed to defence, 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 we'll close the doors, you know, we need to make sure this virus is stopped. Actually, there's lots of really good examples of it. I don't want to drone on too long, apologies, but I think that there are a lot of very good things in terms of principles of this. Part of the concern, I think, is, and I know there's some legislative timeframes, is that how long it will take for this to be realised. And at a meeting with regard to implementation of care home visiting, which I'm part of, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, you know, there's still inconsistencies. Doors are closed for different reasons, because of norovirus or some other mm-hmm. some other things. So it'll be necessary in the future as much as a result of COVID. But, you know, COVID is much better managed now than it was. We're meeting in person, there's no masks, these types of things. We're in a much better place. Vaccination programme, PPE is being used and available. So this is a really, I think, quite sad state of affairs that we're still not a place where residents who need this and family members and carers are able to get exactly what they need everywhere. So until this bill is passed, that won't be mm-hmm. law. But I think broadly speaking, it's doing the right things. But I don't think it's as strong as some who've been calling for it would like.
Mm-hmm. Does Henry or Hannah want to come in on that question?
Yeah, thanks. So I think that there's some really fundamentally and very challenging issues associated with Anne's Law that we have to look at too, and we can't just look at it in separation. And the first thing is that part of the reason that these relatives can't access the premises is because of the very nature, size and scale of the premises. And we know that 1,600 people with dementia probably died as a consequence of living in large-scale group living environments. And going forward, we have to say, is that the right model? Is that the way that we think we can deal with a future pandemic? Because at the time when everything, you know, really evolved, most people placed their trust in public health's understanding of how to handle and deal with this pandemic. Very few people knew how to challenge that or understood what to challenge. Whereas I think the campaigners and the Care Home Relative Group have made the point, they've made their case, they've won that argument, and we can never go back the way on that just now. And I think that as it stands, the option again comes back to public health making decisions. Now, that needs to be challenged. There's other evidence, there's counter evidence, there's emerging strong theories of problem. So I think we're in a different place for a different debate, and some of what, I mean, public health just held all the cards and made all the decisions and never quite understood perhaps the impact that had on these families and individuals, and perhaps still don't. So I feel that we need a bigger public debate about the future of our long-term care estate. We need to question it, consider it, and we never can have families in that position ever again. So it's not just about Anne's Law, it's about the whole position as far as we're concerned as we move forward.
Thank you. Hannah, did I see your hand up previously?
Yeah, just building on Henry's points, which I think we would be very much in agreement there with, would be the imperative to take that learning from the pandemic about process as well about the specifics and use that to inform these discussions. So that could also include around discussions around the right to rehabilitation, the right to independent living, and the way in which consistently throughout the early stages of the pandemic, we did not see disabled people, people living with long-term conditions or unpaid carers, having input in decision-making. And I think that has particular relevance to the proposed framework bill in terms of the material around care board representation, but also the ministerial intervention in case of emergencies, that there's no statement at present about a duty to have respect or to pay attention to the principles of co-production, the principles of human rights outlined in the early sections of the Act. I would be really keen to see that there, because that is the functional threading through of some of that learning that's being referred to there, and the sort of the impetus to not go back that colleagues have just commented on.
Yeah, thank you. In your evidence to committees, the Alliance had suggested there should be scope within the bill for creation of an independent authority to be able to hold ministers to account for their decisions. I just wonder if you could outline what you would see that looking like legally and what legal standing that would have as well.
I should preface this for saying I'm not a legal professional. That is really centred around the concept that it is really important that people can trust in the process. Trust in ministerial oversight, absolutely, but also trust that someone has the capacity to be properly looking out for what is working and what isn't working. Because ministerial accountability, best will in the world, is not going to involve one person who's the CAPSEC with the capacity to go, what is happening in the data we are receiving? What gaps do we have? Where do we not know what standard of care people are receiving? What is being done to combat that? What progress has been made? That has to be done by a team of researchers, bluntly, or some variation on that theme. And part of our proposal for the independent role of that is to reinforce, to support public trust around that process, but also to provide a really useful resource that ministers can draw on as part of that ministerial responsibility role, as well as being held to account. So it's a two-directional process would be the proposal, but also something that I think harks back to some of the earlier comments made around complaints, which is if you have an independent body, they can be part of a more proactive approach to problem solving. In the same way that, say, the care inspectorate's reports, I like good practice. They're not all about saying, you know, we're putting you into special measures, but far from it. So something that can really straddle that space and also be available both for disabled people and people accessing services to be aware of, but also staff and the workforce, so that they can be raising concerns and suggestions and flagging items.
That's helpful. Thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to make any points about that suggestion. If not, happy to hand back. Thanks.
Yeah, nobody has indicated. Thanks, Miles. Okay. So I'm just going to say again, if members can direct their questions, and please just allow the panel to indicate if they want to come in on that question, Please, everybody, keep your questions and responses succinct. And now, we're now going to move to questions from Marie McNair, who's joining us online.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon, panel, and thank you very much for your time this morning. I'm going to follow with the same line of questions from the previous panel. It's obviously, I just want to know about, you know, the impacts of integrated joint boards, and I want to kind of tease out, do you think the model has had enough time to bed in and make a difference, and what are the implications of replacing them with care boards? I know there's been a bit of discussion about that already, but just maybe if you could come in with a expand on that a wee bit, Hannah, if you don't mind.
Yep. So I would say that IJBs, whether they've had long enough, I don't have the same breadth of length of experience as previous colleagues who were involved in the 2014 setup. But what I would say is we have clear evidence that they are not meeting the needs of disabled people, people living in long-term areas on a consistent basis. I think part of that is due to the legislative framing of integration. So the key example that I would give that I think care boards have the potential to meet the problem would be around representation of lived experience and of the third and independent sectors, in that we see real variance between boards that do and don't have those posts in IJBs and those that don't. Maybe they have the available post, but it's not filled, or functionally, actually, the order of business is 9 a.m. meetings where you've got to read 50 pages over the weekend, which people with unpaid, with unpaid care responsibilities, etc., are. We've, you know, frequently heard, I can't do a 9 a.m. slot because that's when the care, when support are coming in. But there's this sort of the nuts and bolts element of it also. The system is not designed, current system, to engage properly with people with lived experience of accessing services. If you have care boards where from the outset it is a prerequisite that people with lived experience are part of them in order for decisions to be quorate, I think that's a very different political landscape at that point in terms of the language of co-production and input on decisions, which is a really key part of that definition. We'd like to see that fed throughout the whole process of wider, you know, health and social care design. What I would say is, although it's very welcome that the bill in its current state acknowledges that possibility and highlights the possibility of paying people properly for their time rather than just expenses, which is another problem in the current system, it's not listed as an essential. And best way in the world, if something is not a requirement, it'll be the first thing that goes when people are under pressure. That'd be something we would really like to see changed in current bill structure. But if care boards can learn from things like the people-led policy panel and the success, some of the really good work that happened around social security and co-production, then that would be really welcome and could potentially be a much more meaningful engagement with co-production on an ongoing basis than we see in IJBs.
Thank you, Hannah. Hannah, do you want to come in on that, please?
Yeah, thank you. I don't think IJBs have worked, and I think that there's a number of very important and significant issues of that sort which have been mentioned. Well, one of the areas I would point to is the process of commissioning and subsequent procurement through IJBs has really led us into a state of, like, you know, the crisis in social care, and where I would specifically highlight that would be this non-committal framework tendering agreement that the IJBs have adopted across the country. And, you know, I was fortunate enough to chair an inquiry on behalf of the Fair Work Convention that looked very carefully at all of this, and we made some recommendations in 2019, one of which was to actually see that the IJBs have actually driven, through these framework agreements, many organisations and indeed I think many of the employees within that to carry the burden of risk and the burden of the availability within social care. And that, for me, is a failure of planning. It's a failure of proper commissioning. That's what leads to organisations having zero-hour contract workers and not knowing how many hours are going to be required. Now, all of that then feeds into the actual willingness and desire of someone to work within social care. We've got, you know, over 1,000 organisations. We've got 200,000 staff. 89% are women. and we don't have any collective voice for that group of workforce at all. And I think that that for me is where social care has started to become more and more under pressure, more greater difficulties, and that lack of really significant planning, proper commissioning, and making sure that organisations are given the right level of contract with the right number of staff to deliver the needs has led to where we are in terms of crisis. So that's one area that IGIBs have struggled with. I don't think the cultures have ever really merged. I think you've got a name and you've got a logo and you've got a label, but have we really got one culture between all that was put into the individual IGIBs? Probably not. And I think we, you know, moving forward, the idea of, like, you know, not having, you know, two different line management structures and two different sort of like reporting procedures and having one national care service seems to make sense, but there's a lot of work to be done to deliver on that.
Thanks, Henry. And following up, do you recognise the situation expressed by the Minister last week that currently people feel they've been pushed from pillar to post if they, for example, have a complaint or concerns about the service? You share that view?
Yeah, well, I think what happens in you know, that it's very difficult, first of all, to find out who to complain to, how to complain, where to go to. And I think that the you know, my experience of people is that they really only complain when things get really serious and really significant. And I would certainly support that. I think that's very fair and a true and accurate reflection of what's happening right there just now.
Thank you. Very briefly, does anyone else want to come in on that question?
Adam.
Really brief. I think if you look at accountability for IGBs, there isn't that much in terms of the public. If you ask the public who are on IGBs, what do they do, I think there's very low understanding. I'll refer back to a report from Audit Scotland a couple of years ago. They were talking about how they just haven't worked yet. It's a very good question about whether they need more time. But do we have time to wait for that? Will that in itself fix social care? If it's such a broad kind of ask, in a sense, is fixed social care. It's pretty tricky, isn't it? But I think that there's, if you're going to look at a national care service, there's a model to support that through care boards. But I think IGBs, despite a lot of good work, have been, you know, maybe even commissioning work has been a race to the bottom in terms of the cheapest costs for people to deliver, to procure care. I think there's a lot more that they could do, and I don't think we've got time to see if that settles.
Thanks, Adam. Hannah, I see you wanted to come back in on the people being moved from pillar to post question. Yeah.
Yeah, just on that second question. Yes, they are. But I think one specific area I'd like to flag that I think is often not a lot of attention is paid for to is that the need for a complaint system and that sort of redress situation to be accessible to family and friends of people who accessed care or wish to access care and have since passed away. At the moment, the current system, essentially investigation ceases in many cases after an individual has died, and that is not fair on those families, it's not fair on those individuals. It also sets a really poor precedent in terms of learning and the ability to build upon when things don't work. So we would strongly welcome material that would alter that current state of play.
Thank you, Hannah. No further questions, Camino.
Thank you, Marie, and thanks, Hannah, for flagging up that aspect. Mark, you've got some questions.
Yep. Thanks, Convener. We've heard concerns from local authorities and trade unions about the prospect of a wholesale transfer of staff and assets to a new national service. And the Minister last week tried to allay those by saying it would only be as a provider of last resort and in result of a failure. Just wanted to maybe come to Hannah first and ask if you know what's kind of led to that level of confusion. Why was there such a concern amongst the sector about a wholesale transfer of staff, and what your view actually would have been if that comes to pass?
I think that this is responding off on the hoof, but I have not, and a number of colleagues have not, read the bill in the same way that has since been outlined by the Minister. Though the understanding had been that there is the possibility of wholesale movement of staff and that this did cause understandable concern.
particularly among other areas in the bits where sections where it was explicit that NHS staff would not be moved, and questioning, well, what does that mean for NHS Highland, who provides social care via for adult services? So there was some significant confusion amongst third sector colleagues around those sections. If, as the Minister outlines, transfer staff will only happen in emergency, then I would return to my comments about being clear on the definition of an emergency, the length of time, whether something is permanent or short term, and how the human rights of both people accessing services and workforce and fair work embedded throughout that are going to be respected throughout any such process. I think material on that would reassure, because at the moment there's considerable uncertainty in this sector that is already struggling and under considerable pressures, and so stress is not a desirable addition in that context. Does that make sense?
Yep, yep, thanks. I don't know if Adam or Henry wanted to come in.
No.
No, okay, that's fine. My other question was just around trust. The review report said that trust is not currently in plentiful supply in social care support, and wonder whether you'd agree with that, whether you would recognise that there is a difference in trust in social care and in the NHS, and why you think that might be. Come to Adam first.
I think there's certainly an issue of trust, and it's both sides, I think, for those who receive social care and those who are delivering social care. I think a lot of folks, in terms of like key workers in social care, might have a lack of trust in the system or in the maybe even their employers or kind of what they are getting themselves in terms of not just their kind of pay, but conditions and training and all the types of things that support this. You've got unpaid carers who've got an extraordinary heavy burden on them to try and pick up everything when it comes to making sure that their loved one is in the best health they can possibly be. But I think if you looked at the last 2.5 years to 3 years, and social care has had probably the worst period of PR it could ever have had, not for want of trying to do a really good job. You know, it's just been faced with a crisis, and actually the beginning of the COVID, when care homes are essentially, and social care providers, left on their own to try and find PPE. You know, we've heard these stories, we can't forget that. That people were going on Amazon to try and find anything, you know, but it was channeled, broadly speaking, to the NHS. Now, whether this was a decision, it might all come out in the wash with an independent inquiry, UK and Scottish, but how these things happened. So response and what happened in social care meant that it was hard to deliver it because of these types of things. So there was certainly a kind of it felt like, talking about trust, it felt like the NHS was protected far more than social care. And I think that's an incredible hangover from that. And as people had their social care packages removed with no warning, or indeed not returned to levels which were initially assessed as their need, so this is the point, it's not just about what you get now, is at some point you've been assessed as needing this care. And then all of a sudden, you no longer need that much care. So I think there are big challenges there. And it's a lot of this is about resource and making sure you can access it when you need it and as much as you need.
Thank you. Thanks. I don't know if there's anyone on there.
And, oh, yes. So, Henry, you'd like to come in, and I think you wanted to come in on the previous question as well. So if you can pull that in, that would be great.
Just in terms of the trust issue, I think what's really important to understand is that the majority of the public get a surprise when they start to require social care services, because they end up in this form of financial assessment. They end up having to contribute and having to pay for it. And that has been very varied across 32 different authorities. But particularly for our group of people who are most concerned about, when people reach that advanced stage of dementia, they might need to go to a care home. They're then, you know, facing bills of £1,200 per week. So they think that care is going to be free. The public generally thinks care is going to be free. And when you enter the social care arena and you realise it isn't, it obviously will affect your perception of that. It's almost like a damaged psychological contract that we've got, that you work your whole life and then all of a sudden you need something but you have to pay either a component for all of that. So that really impacts, in my opinion, on the trust. Whereas with NHS, you never experience that, and you tend to receive the care that you require, albeit you may have to wait sometimes in various situations for it. So we've got two very different approaches and very different structures, but actually a very similar perspective around that, and that ultimately leads to quite a significant damage of trust. And indeed, we have got a campaign that's targeting the inequalities around that, which I won't get to introduce now. But I really do think that, that's something that you must bear in mind, that, social care has always had this means-tested charging ability that actually makes people very confused and, causes a trust failure.
Thanks, Henry. Okay, we're going to move on to questions from Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. A couple of questions, I think, for me. One we've talked about before in the previous session as well, and about we've kind of been discussing about the framework. This is a framework element of the bill, and it's kind of moving on to the co-design would be the next stage. Just to ask the panel what they would see their part in the co-design, or what they would like to see as their part in the co-design process as we move forward. And the second question. The Minister mentioned last week that the National Care Service represents the greatest opportunity that has existed for the profession for a very long time. Just your thoughts on that comment as well. And I'll open it up probably to yourself, Hannah, first of all, and then open it up beyond that.
I mean, first up, the Alliance is very interested in being involved in co-production work so that we can share as many opportunities as widely as possible with our membership. What I would say the feedback we have had from them thus far is that the existing structures around the co-production work, although much of it is really good, are not transparent. And that goes back to those questions about trust that have just been outlined. So I think that we could be seeing ongoing improvement also in terms of inclusive communication and access.
Hannah, just in terms of specific population groups. Just on that point, you're saying not transparent. What would you like to see if that, in case of more transparency?
So, off the top of my head, it's really welcome that you've got the lived experience expert panels. It wasn't clear from the information shared whether this was selective, whether everybody who wanted to be involved would be involved. Just kind of basic comms, essentially.
Yep.
But also, a lot of the information is shared online only. What does that do around digital choice and digital access and what paid population groups? I'm just not going to hear about stuff. There are a lot of material there. And I think also there are concerns we have heard from within our membership about the timescales, particularly given the different developments across what I'm going to call mainstream National Care Service work and the questions about whether to include justice services and children and young people services. Real concerns about making sure we don't retrofit children and young people services are included, because a retrofitted system is not going to be fit for purpose, it's not going to be properly co-produced. So making sure that co-production work is fully inclusive of all potential groups from the very outset, because universal accessibility is no bad thing, even if things and even if those parts of the system are not in the end included. With regard to opportunity, the mentions of fair work are really welcome, but not having a lot of detail has raised some concerns. So there's the potential for this to be an opportunity. At the moment, we know that, yes, there was pay up left for social care staff, but pay uplift doesn't come with an ongoing promotional sort of track in the way that NHS have. So something that could do that would be really welcome. Similarly, that uplift did not apply to children and young people's social care workers. But there's some existing disparities that are still being perpetuated. Can that be addressed? We've also heard substantially from, say, colleagues, for example, within the sensory loss sector, who talk about the level of expertise required to be a guide communicator and that that is not noticed or acknowledged within the current systems, either in terms of continued professional development or in terms of pay and conditions. So lots of scope to improve. Whether the bill will improve that is another question, but the opportunity is welcome, particularly if there's a real drive to get into that nuts and bolts stuff and see meaningful improvement for the sector.
Okay, Anna, thank you for that.
Thanks, and Henry wants to come in on that one.
Thank you. If I just start with the opportunity, first of all, I think that the National Care Service has to have a national agreed body that represents the social care workforce alongside it. We need standard terms and conditions. We need to move away from the variety that we've got across the whole sector and give people a strength and security. Again, that was recommended by the Fair Work Conventions report, and it's not happened yet, and it really does need to happen. In terms of sort of co-design, I think that, I mean, it's very difficult to co-design the next stage of this bill, but including everyone, and I think it's got to be chunked down into specific bits of work, bits of in the areas, and people need to be brought in and engaged from the beginning, but perhaps at more depth across different pieces. So, for example, we as an organisation have been campaigning working with members for 40 years. We've got, you know, many thousands of members. We've got active voice groups. They all want to be part of this. And we have to find a way, I think, at the right point in time, using that skill and that expertise, and using and relying, I think, on the third sector, because the third sector exists to do the very thing that the government now wants to be done. I don't think the government needs to create a new methodology of like co-production than we've been doing, but quite frankly, decades. I think there's a lot to be learned from our sector, and we can do a lot more in partnership as opposed to create some new structures that perhaps, you know, will be helpful in a central component. But there's a lot out there, a lot of organisations out there that can really be engaged and supported. However, that does require some investment, it requires some funding, it requires some thought.
Thanks.
Adam.
Yeah.
I think first part there was with regard to involvement. I think there is a lot that of insight from older people, carers, family members, the Age Scotland's helpline will have collated over many, many, many years. The advisors on that will know what people are calling about in terms of what is good, what's not so good. I think that's something which we would want to offer in terms of that kind of general public take on it. They've also got elements of work which they're to support you know, people with experience of dementia, which we'll have, ethnic minority older people, LGBTQ plus older people as well. They're making sure that their voices, their experiences, indeed their aspirations for social care are heard. And I think this is as much about the future as it is about today and fixing, you know, the National Care Service isn't going to fix the problems we're facing in social care today, tomorrow, but we're looking into the future. We want to make sure that as more people may need it, and whoever you are and whatever you might need wherever you are, that that is fully recognised and understood. And also for organisations like Age Scotland and many, many others to test the ideas and to scrutinise some of the ideas that are coming out of co-design and co-production to actually work out in reality, do we think that this will work or not? I think that's another part, is that we often have this with the government about let's have a blank sheet of paper and all come together and create this thing. Actually, sometimes you want a little bit of leadership as well from the government, say this is how it will work in actual practice, this is the framework that we've got, this is how the world operates. What do you think could improve that, or where do you think the kind of blocks to this happening are?
OK. Adam, thank you for that. Okay, no conscious of time, so that's me.
Thanks, Paul. So that we've come to the end of our questions, and I thank you all for joining us and giving evidence today. I think it's been useful for the committee to hear your reflections on the National Care Service Bill. And as we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private, there's no more public business today, and I now close the public part of the meeting.